Well, welcome to the Winter Equestrian Festival and a beautiful evening ahead for the $500,000 Rolex Grand Prix here tonight. The culmination of the weeks and delighted to have Rolex as our presenting sponsor, offering a warm welcome here and a main sponsor since 2012 and honoured to be the official timepiece of the Wellington International and title sponsor of tonight's headline, the Rolex Grand Prix. Also partners of the four majors around the world, the Dutch Masters, Arken, Spruce Meadows for the Masters there too, and CHI Geneva as well, that make up the Rolex Grand Slam of Jumping, part of the Rolex family, and our thanks to them once again. A big night ahead, an exciting night ahead, brought to you by Rolex. And to our presenting sponsors of today's pre-show, it is Jumper once again, and Jumper, the official stats provider to the Wellington International. All the stats to talk through and our streaming brought to you by Dodd Technologies, the industry leaders in creative design and technical support for sports, entertainment, corporate and special events. And you can visit them online at doddtechnologies.com as well. And brought to you in partnership with the USEF in support between the US Equestrian Federation and the USEF network as well. So all of our supporters there bringing you tonight what is going to be an exciting class and an exciting lineup of riders alongside me to talk it through of what to expect from this, the biggest night of the season here from the Winter Equestrian Festival. Alongside me, three stars that have been there and done it, I'm delighted to say, and alongside me, starting with double Olympic gold medalist BZ Madden. BZ, good evening.
Good evening, thanks for having me.
You've been dashing around the course, we'll come on to that in a few minutes' time, yes. But it's a big night.
Yeah, it's very big, it's exciting, the rain looks beautiful, and I think it's going to be a tough competition with a good field.
Lauren Huff, delighted to have you alongside, of course, Pan Am medalist as well, Grand Prix winner here in Wellington. You know what it's like to get in there. It's a bit of a nerve-wracking night as well.
Hi, Stephen. Yes, it's the culmination of a very long 12 weeks. Some of these horses have been here and jumped quite a bit. We have a few new ones that just shipped in for the week, and you've got the best of the best in the world tonight, and it's always going to be a great, great evening.
Speaking of those who shipped in for the week, Conor Swale of Ireland. Conor, major rider, top 10 rider as well. You've been winning Grand Prix aplenty over in California. You've popped in for the week, you've won two classes, and now you're sitting and having a rest.
Yeah, I decided to sit tonight out. But yeah, I think it's going to be very exciting there. There's 40 very good riders and horses there, so it'll be interesting to see who comes out in top.
Well, it's the culmination of a season, so let's take a little look back at what has already happened throughout the Winter Equestrian Festival as well. We've completed already three five-star Grand Prix before now too, and there's been some really exciting ones. Let's take a look at our first, which was the Fidelity Investments Grand Prix on what we call week five. Dara Kenny and Amsterdam taking home the first of the Grand Prix of the season. Conor Swale, the Irishman, getting you guys off to a good start.
Yeah, this horse had been off for a few years, and I think they did a great job getting him back to competing at this level again. And it's it looks fairly likely that he's going to maybe be part of our Olympic squad as well. So it is great to see Dara doing so well on Amsterdam, and looks like a great partnership.
Absolutely, grandstand finish for them in that Fidelity class on to that first five-star of the season. Our second five-star was no big surprise there, as it was a German win, and it was Richard Vogel of Germany with United Touch, a very special horse indeed, as we take a look at this one. And Lauren, I mean, this horse eats the ground for breakfast.
This was an incredible jump off. I mean, the horse just turns amazing. It can drop strides like no other horse in the class. And it was a pleasure to watch.
So certainly an exciting one for him. Now, he's going tonight with his winning horse from last year. That was Sapanu Balubay. So he's elected not to go with United Touch this time. So he's mixing things up a bit, but going to go with the faithful combination that got the job done in 2023. As we can see here, this was a very special run indeed at this Lugano double. It was here as well after just scooped it up towards the last, and it was job done for the German rider onto Lugano Diamonds week there as well. The five-star week that completed those just a few weeks ago, well, we call week nine, but is the Bainbridge Grand Prix, more importantly, was an exciting one too, and a very special story as well, with essentially an amateur of the sport winning our fives there, Luciana Locio of Brazil. A lawyer by trade, but she certainly laid the law down to them that night. BZ, She's been performing well through the Nations Cups for Brazil and really picked it up that night.
Yeah, for sure she has been doing well, and I think the horse is phenomenal, and I think the partnership is really what does it. You know, she seems to have grown with this horse from up the levels, and it's just tries its heart out for her, and she believes in it, and she just goes. She's game, the horse is game, and they got it done.
They got it done. Pretty magical night for Luciana. From that point of view, she had a tremendous finish there. I think still taking it in from that point of view. She did well last week as well. They were over the line, done and dusted. And they're all the completed five-star winners so far this season. We've got one more to add to the list. The question is who it is going to be. Do we take anything out of the form we've seen so far already, Lauren, or not? Or do we start again?
I think people that have been here this winter and been in good form and have multiple horses, they definitely plan wisely and make sure that their best horse is peaking tonight. Ben Mayer's been in great form. He's got a lovely, lovely group of horses. Kent Farrington hasn't won one yet, and I know he's anxious to win one, as he always is. Laura Kraut's bringing a younger one up tonight, so it's anyone's day, I think.
Absolutely. We'll talk about those details as we go. Beasy, five-star weeks here in Wellington, especially this last one, the Rolex Grand Prix. It just has a bit of a different feel.
Yeah, I think it's generally hard jumping down here with five stars. You know, you have a good field. You have horses that are on top form. And I think that's why you see people mixing their horses. You know, some of the ones you saw on the video already today aren't going tonight because people, I think if you did every five-star with one horse, you'd have not a lot of horse left in the circuit.
They bought some fresh legs out.
The ones that can switch them in and out are obviously doing well.
They're going to be really good stuff. Christian Kukuk is going to be prime coming out from the qualifier because the winner of the qualifier this week in the WEF Challenge Cup was you, Connor.
Yes.
But you're here.
Yeah. There's a few European guys came down from Ocala after last week, and it'll be interesting to see how they go. You know, they haven't really done an awful lot actually over the 2 weeks, to be honest. And I'd say those guys will be pushing hard to try and get a good result as well.
Christian Kukuk gets the prime spot there. We've got a few of the Europeans that have come down from there. We've got Petter Fredriksson in there. We've got Peter DeVos. A few to shake things up.
Yes, it'll be very interesting. Like I see, like even Christian, you know, the horse that he was sacking with, he's not using that tonight. Yeah. He's switching horses and. You know, so he's had one good result and he's looking for another good result with his different horse this week. And yeah, you have Petter and you have Tupi with Peter DeVos is a wonderful horse as well. So honestly, you know, when you look at the 40, there's not so many don't have a chance.
But you Irish have been sweeping up the classes with enthusiasm.
Yeah, the Irish boys have, you know, they're having a good run for sure. Obviously, I be hoping for an Irish win tonight. I think she, obviously Shane is, I'm sure, you know, like he's one of the favourites. He's one of the best horses in the world. You know, you have Daniel towards the end. That's a new horse for him. I'm not so sure whether, you know, like today will be his day, but I think he's more just finding out what kind of an animal he has at the moment. So, there's enough guys in there that obviously, again, who have we? We have... who we're looking for here. We're looking for...
We've got some Sweetnams, we've got some pearls.
Again, Keane, I mean, there exactly, there's Keane, actually.
He has to get his glasses on there.
Yeah, sorry, I have to get my glasses. Yeah, Keane with Maurice, he only had to jump once last week and he jumped a clear round. I'd say he'll be hoping for a double clear. And then Dara has switched horses from last week as well, jumped a great round last week. So there's so many good guys there.
But enough about the Irish. Beasy, the American riders are going to come out for this quite strong, aren't they?
Yes, I think so. As Lauren said, I think Kent is hungry to win, and we all know McLean is always hungry to win. He hasn't won a five-star yet. He was close. I think he was second
one week,
and he has a new horse for him, yeah. And I think it's going to be a challenge for him tonight, but I also think probably as a combination, they're up to the challenge, and I think it's maybe time that the horse shines tonight. It could be a win for him.
Lauren, we also look at form horses and form riders from that point of view. Is there anyone in the last few weeks you've sort of gone, if they keep going in that direction? Because it's been pretty well spread so far.
Yeah, I mean, to be honest, I think we've there isn't one horse rider combination that you would say is really, like Beezy said here, you have to switch the horses out, you know. Yeah. If you're lucky enough to have a few, it's hard jumping here, and she's right in that you're not going to see, I wouldn't say most any of these have done all three five stars. I don't know for sure, but
they've been kept. Yes. They've been kept
and
ready.
Really, you know, it's a championship year. We've got a big year ahead of us. We just had Ocala Nations Cup last week, so there's a lot on the plate. Then there's a couple big five stars coming up the next 2 weeks as well.
They've got plenty to go for today, that's the thing. And as you say, we're going to talk to some of those riders in a few moments' time. You mentioned Laura Crout and McLean Wall. We're going to delve into the details there. We haven't even got to Ben Mayer and the fact that world number one is here, Henrik von Eckermann, as well. So we'll get to those in a few moments' time too, as well, to discuss all of that. And we'll be discussing that after the break in just a moment's time. Thanks to Rolex as well. As I say, the four Grand Slam tennis tournaments and all the majors in golf, Rolex is a long-term partner of prestigious sporting institutions. And to Jumper as well, our official provider of stats here to this program. We're back in a few moments' time.
It is not a machine, though the precision of its mechanics can draw some admiration. Propelled by a unique movement, graced with a singular drive, it has a personality of its own. It was born from a special bond. Crafted over years with infinite patience and utmost care, listening to every tick, going over every move again and again, to build a trust like no other. The kind of trust that allows you to push further, higher. Always. The kind of trust that can transcend any challenge.
Is he?
With James Bond.
Well, welcome back, and we're heading into tonight's big five-star Grand Prix, $500,000 Rolex Grand Prix as well. Like I say, we've also had an exciting list too, including that Lugano Diamonds Grand Prix, thanks to them as a major sponsor here at Wellington too. And shining out down in the warm-up is Danny Woolman. Danny's been catching up with some other riders, getting what it feels like down there. Very good evening, Danny.
Good evening, Stephen. Thanks so much. I'm here with Kian O'Connor. Kian, how's it look out there? You took a look and walked around. How's it look?
Thanks, Danny. Yeah, it looks a proper course, as you'd expect, I suppose, for the Rolex final here. Big from the start, which is what's very noticeable, and get into it quite early on with the wall down to the triple combination.
Yeah. What do you think is particularly unique about tonight's course?
I think it's Guillerme has been here for the full 12 weeks, so he's watching the different course builders come in, and he's been able to have the advantage of seeing what's being built and what's left. The water jump plays its role, there's a plank after, it's a big oxer. There's no real let up, and he's used the double combination towards the second half of the course beside a little water stream at the open water as well, which some horses might spook from.
Yeah, absolutely. All right, thanks, Kian. Good luck tonight.
Thanks a million.
Stephen, back to you.
Thank you, Danny. Yes, she's going to be with us throughout our program tonight as well. So let's start delving into the stats on our riders to take a look at who might be the contenders tonight. It's a big field of 40, so it's going to be a tough one to pick our way through, but we'll give it a go. And we picked out some big names in there too. And Laura Crout is certainly one of those that we're taking a look at. Of course, she had some fantastic runs in the early part of the season. Let's take a look at her stats. And as Lauren said, she's riding Biscetta tonight, Biscuit, so not quite as experienced to horse, 10 rounds to 150. Clear round rate a little less there because, again, they haven't had the experience. Just over four faults, 5.3 as an average there. But four faults or better, just at 0.5. So looking good there. Lauren herself, of course, 20 WEF Grand Prix wins there for Laura, and also 10 podiums for Laura as well. So she's been pretty well experienced here too from that point of view. She's got plenty behind her. Not worried about that. Here's Biscetta competing earlier on in the season. She was also down into that Nations Cup as well. Lauren, you're very familiar with this pair.
Yeah, Laura's very, very high on this mare. I love the mare. I love the type. She's been finagling the bit, and I think that's been her biggest sort of, I wouldn't call it setback, but learning curve at the moment.
Yeah.
She started with, I think, a normal bridle, then back to a pony hackamore, which wasn't enough, and then in the WEF the other day, she had the big hackamore connected with a snaffle, and that seemed like, I think, the best round sort of connection-wise. So I think it's going to be a big ask tonight, not because the horse isn't capable, it's just that it's going to probably be the biggest thing this horse
they
has
haven't seen it
for
before.
Sure.
Yeah, absolutely. Laura Kraut, though, still always high on all the lists. She was, of course, a five-star Grand Prix winner here last year as well. She's done it plenty of times. Mm. She knows how to do it. If any pilot can guide a horse around this with confidence, it's her.
Yeah, I mean, for me, her horse last week in the Nations Cup was the two rounds of the whole night. It jumped absolutely phenomenal.
Valentinou, yeah.
I think she needs to keep that one in bubble wrap before Paris. but, yeah, I always... wish her the very best.
Absolutely. Well, Laura Kraut, of course, in there. And we're going to take a look at another home favourite as well in McLean Ward, of course, winner of the Grand Prix on week 10. He's won more Grand Prix here now than anyone. He's holding on to that record. And as we were saying, he's riding a different horse tonight in Ilex as well. So again, a little bit of an unknown quantity there. But here we go with the combination together. One round at 150. There we go. Clear rounds there. Just go four faults average because they've just done that round together. And let's look at McLean's stats there. 23 Grand Prix wins, 13 podiums, including just a few weeks' time into that second spot in the five-star Grand Prix there as well. So for him, he's into a little bit of unknown territory. We're here with Contagious, and we've seen how successful he can be. BZ, you've ridden on with him plenty of teams.
Yeah.
He's not going to worry too much about that lack of experience tonight because the horse jumps fantastically. We've seen it here plenty of times.
Yeah, he won't worry at all. There's nobody better than McLean to hop on a horse and get some good rounds out of it. And, you know, he's always had success early with new horses, so it won't be a surprise if he does do well tonight. And saying that that's a new combination, the horse does have plenty of experience, actually.
Yeah.
Nations Cup, big Nations Cups and Grand Prix, and obviously McLean does as well, and I think he's watched the horse and known the horse for a couple of years now, because the horse has competed down here, so the horse actually knows the ring as well. So I wouldn't count him out tonight.
Absolutely. We saw the horse with Fabio Levis da Costa into the Nations Cup here as well, and it was the horse that stood out from that point.
And it's done some Nations Cups in Europe, and big ones there, so it for sure has...
And McLean, did he not ride that one in the Nations Cup here as well?
He rode it, yes.
Week eight.
Yeah.
I believe he used it for four and clear.
So he's got all the ingredients in the right place.
Yes.
McLean Ward, then, we could still bring off a home win. He's won it several times before, of course, the closing Grand Prix here with a great Sapphire as well. And going back has really been a huge part of the history of this Grand Prix at the end of season two. Let's also take a look at one we've mentioned already. He was the winner of the Fidelity Grand Prix this season, and that's Dara Kenny of Ireland. VDL Cartello is Olympic ride this time. 31 rounds they've done, a little bit more experience between these two. And faults average of 2.2, so less than four faults. Four faults are better, 0.97% of the time. Connor, from this point of view, Dara and VDL Cartello should be a good combination. Here's Amsterdam from the other day winning, but he would like to double this up.
Yes, again, the horse also had been coming back from injury there lately. He's done some very good things. And again, last week in Ocala, jumped a super round, actually should have been clear. That was a very difficult Grand Prix. So he's coming in here with decent form, I feel. The horse looks very good, looks back to his best. So he definitely will have a good shot tonight.
Certainly one of the big Irish ones tonight. We're going to talk about two others coming up in just a moment because we do have a number of the world's top five here too. So we'll be back after the break in just a moment to discuss those that could take a big part of this here tonight. Like I say, we have five of the world's top 10 competing here and around 15 of the world's top 30 in tonight's Grand Prix as well. So it's a certainly very strong one as well. Join us after the break as we take a look at the world's top two here in Wellington here tonight as part of the Rolex Grand Prix.
It is not a machine, though the precision of its mechanics can draw some admiration. Propelled by a unique movement, graced with a singular drive, it has a personality of its own. It was born from a special bond. Crafted over years with infinite patience and utmost care, listening to every tick, going over every move again and again to build a trust like no other, the kind of trust that allows you to push further, higher, always, the kind of trust that can transcend any challenge.
Well, welcome back, and coming to our pre-show, brought to you by Jumper as well, the official stats provider here to the Wellington International. Thank you very much to them. Take a look at their app. You can see all the stats on all the horses and riders, literally everywhere. And to Bainbridge Company as well, proud sponsors of the Winter Equestrian Festival here for a number of years now, long-time supporters, and great to have them on board once again. And our presenting sponsor tonight, Rolex. For almost 70 years, Rolex has been a global contributor to equestrianism, demonstrating the enduring commitment to some of the oldest and most revered events within the sport. Thank you to Rolex. And it is a big money night and big star night, because what we haven't touched on yet is that we have the world's number one and world's number two with us tonight as well. So first up, we're going to go in reverse order, as they say, and we're going to go with the world number two, but he's certainly number one in many's book because he's the Olympic champion as well. And it is Ben Mayer. So let's take a look at Ben's stats. Dallas Vegas Batty here tonight, 24 rounds together for them, 46% of the time jumping clear. Faults just 3.1, so they're under four faults there. And Grand Prix wins for Ben. He's been racking up those this season as well. 21 of those. Grand Prix podiums, 12. He won the Nations Cup Grand Prix a few weeks ago. He won the Grand Prix going back to the first week too. He has been on absolutely flying form. And as I say, the world number two brings out one of the big string of horses that he can go to here. Lauren, Ben's got some options and he's gone with Dallas.
I am a huge fan of this mare. I think she's just a class act.
Yeah.
The rounds that I've seen them do, I really am a big fan of hers. And
this was him winning the Grand Prix on week one as well with Anjou. I mean, he's got so many options to go to, is the thing.
Yeah. Anyhow, I think he has a very good chance. He manages his horses beautifully. He always picks the right events for them to prep and then to shine. And I think with a little luck, everybody always needs a little luck in this sport. If he has a clear, I think he could. He's early to go in the order, yeah. Or sort of early-ish. If he sets down a quick time in the beginning, he could be hard to beat.
He's won this before, won with Serena a few years ago as well. That was an interesting, I think it was just a double clear that won on that occasion. It was
what
a very
year
different.
Was that?
going back, I'll tell you in a second. But BZ, I mean, such a stylish rider to watch, Ben.
Yeah, beautiful. And, you know, like Lauren said, he manages his horses well. I think he does all his homework. You know, you see him out there doing very classical flat work. You know, it just looks like everything is systematic, planned out, and leads to some mostly a dependable result.
Yeah, absolutely.
You know, I think that's why you see not only a good clear round average, but also four faults or better was 75% for him. So, you'd love to count on somebody like that.
You like those stats.
Yes.
You like those stats from that point of view. Ben Mayer, world number two, going for his third Grand Prix win here this season. He won back in 2016 with Serena from that point of view. Into the Rio Olympic year, of course, designer here, of course, designed the courses in 2016 in Rio as well. Let's go to the number one, and he's making a flying visit here to Wellington. He was here a couple of seasons ago, Henrik von Eckermann. Khaleesi this time, again, going with a horse that hasn't had as much experience, went well up in Ocala just the other day, jumped 9 rounds together, was top 5 in the Madrid World Cup as well, going to the tail end of last year. False average of 1.3, and they're 67% for four faults or better. We talked to him, and we'll hear from him a little bit later. Connor, he says he rates his chances a little less. We don't at all. I mean, he didn't have the best time when he came last time. He's looking to put that right this time around with Khaleesi.
Yeah, you know, we were just talking about he has had a sort of a quiet few weeks here, and listen, he's not world number one for any other reason than, you know, he's very competitive and gets great results. So that would tell me that there is a big result just coming around the corner. I don't really know this horse that well, to be honest. Again, we were just talking about it, that it jumped quite well. Again, up in Ocala there, and it's maybe just new enough to this level. So it'll be interesting to see.
Be very interesting to see indeed. So Henrik van Eckermann, the world number one, is in the equation. The world number two is in the equation, and a whole list of the world's top five are in the equation as well. Thanks to Jumper once again, our official stats provider here, and to Fidelity as well, who presented our Grand Prix back onto week five as well. We're going to be back in just a few moments' time after a short break to take the final picks of who is coming up for today, who our riders have picked as the potential winner of today's Rolex $500,000 Grand Prix here in Wellington.
I share my life with them. I think we're lucky that we get to do what we do, and I've never looked at it as a sacrifice.
For me, being on the horse is the one place I can truly be myself.
They do have a language, you just have to learn how to speak it.
Remember that they feed off of our energies, and so if you're in a good mood or you're happy, they'll reflect that back.
You meet people from all over the world. You have friends that share the same passion for horses, and I think that's something very special.
Horses is the only constant thing in my life, and they will always be there when I need it.
For me, it's connection.
They make me who I am.
It's very hard to explain. It's magical.
It's just who we are.
In one word, it's freedom.
For me, it's everything.
My first goal when I decided to be a professional, it's to become like the best horsewoman I can be. It's really important for me to find the balance with my family, with the horses, that is my passion. Work with the horses every day to do what I love. I used to have like one passion was the horses, and now I have two with my daughter. So I really want to have this balance in my life. I'm Marie Écart, I'm a professional show jumper representing France, and I'm Lola's mom.
Be mindful, be present, turn on your brain.
Well, welcome back, and thank you to USEF as well, presented in part all our programs here in support of the USEF and US Equestrian Federation, who've been a big part of all our programs throughout the season here from Wellington and the Winter Equestrian Festival. And to Jumper once again, our official stats provider here to the Winter Equestrian Festival 2, guiding us towards those winners and just narrowing the field to see what the stats say behind all of those competing here. And of course, to our presenting sponsor Rolex of tonight's $500,000 class, the official timepiece of Wellington International and title sponsor tonight as well, and partner of the four equestrian majors, two around the world, the Dutch Masters, Arken, CSIO Spruce Meadows Masters, and the CHI in Geneva as well, that make up the Rolex Grand Slam of jumping. So with all of that on the table to come, we've got plenty of prize money to go for. Beezy, the difference is with this Grand Prix and being here in Wellington, a lot of the riders, it's almost home ground for them because they live here through the season. You've been here, you've done it. How different is it? Do you find it harder? Do you find it easier? What's the difference between, if you like, home and away?
I think there's advantages and disadvantages to that. I mean, if you're lucky enough, you have a nice farm here that the horses can freshen up on, and you can do what you like to do at home and have your own rein and own set of jumps. And you know, be carry on as if you're just training your horse and then go to the show on Tuesday. So
do you feel it different in the stadium as well, because you're home crowd?
Yeah, I think it's, yeah, they but definitely are cheering for the Americans, I think, and it's quite a good atmosphere generally here on a Saturday night, so it's fun and exciting, and I think that's what helps make it fresh every Saturday night. You know, it'd be a little bit of a Groundhog Day if you came here and there was not much atmosphere, but I think having it at Saturday night lights, and it makes it very special.
It gives lots to it. So, Lauren, we've got a few European visitors that have headed in for the week. Do you think they've got an advantage or a disadvantage?
You know, it's hard jumping here. I think if you have a horse that doesn't have a ton of experience, I think some of these Europeans did bring their older horses, but if you have a horse that's a little bit on the greener side and they haven't had the chance to get into this ring under the lights before, maybe at a softer level, it's in my opinion, a big ask. But obviously the ones that are here are the best in the world, the riders, and they, you know, I'm sure have the utmost confidence, but it's a lot to see under these lights tonight.
It's a lot to do. So everybody's pretty well level playing field.
Home
or away doesn't matter. It's not like the football. Okay, let's take a look at the picks of what all of you have decided on for tonight as well. And let's start with Lauren. And Lauren, you were going with Kent Farrington.
I am going with Kent. He didn't have the best week last week with this horse. Actually, he had a beautiful first round of the Nations Cup. He's been tinkling with some bits, and I don't know, I just have a feeling that he's hungry for a win tonight. So that's where my bet is.
Okay, Connor Swale, where are you going tonight? Who's your pick?
I'm going to go with my fellow countryman, Shane Sweetman, again. He has, you know, he's been careful with his horse throughout this 12 weeks. Jumped clear in the WEF, didn't go in the jump off, so I think he's prepped up for tonight, so I think he'll not be far away.
He's going to be ready to go. Beasy, we're all waiting. Beasy, who's your pick?
I'm going to go with Ben Mayer, mostly because of what I said. You see how accurately he rides, how well-trained his horses are. It makes sense that he should go well. He knows the horse well. He's had a lot of experience with it. The horse knows the rein. I think he's probably primed for tonight.
Absolutely. And I've gone with Harry Charles because I was going to the British end of things as well with the world number 13. So we will see. Harry Charles, of course, world number 13, 24 years of age, looks fantastic. Started off his first week here with a win as well, and hungry for it again with the fabulous Arolyn Blue. So we'll see how they fare. He'll also get all the advice from Dad Pete, who's won here before as well. So those are our picks. And I think Danny's going to be taking a little chat with someone as well to take a look and get their thoughts down there. And she's got a really experienced head on the shoulders down there to get the thoughts from. And we'll be coming to her in just a moment, because it's all about gathering everybody's thoughts to give you a little bit of an idea of who might win. As I say, it's a wide field, 40 of them in all here tonight. And she's got one of the most experienced there. It is a very good evening, Danny, to a legend.
Thanks, Stephen. All right, I'm here with Ludger Bierbaum. Ludger, welcome.
Thank you very much.
All right, so you've taken a look out there. We were just having a conversation about how the time allowed might play a role. Talk about that a little bit.
Yes, I think it pretty much depends on if the time is tight and you have to ride a bit quicker and don't have time to prepare different lines. It's for sure a disadvantage. In general, I think it's a tough course, really. I think as expected, I mean, end of the tour, week 12, Rolex final, it's a tough course. Strong field, but I'm really looking forward to the next few hours.
Me too. All right, you're here and helping Christian Kukuk a little bit. Tell us, he was very good in the Challenge Cup, but on a different horse. Do you think that tonight's course suits Checker, who he's riding tonight?
Of course, I hope so. No, but I think Checker is really right now his number one horse almost. He has been in the last few months really in super shape. He jumped him yesterday, the 150 here, just to get going smooth, really jumped well. He seems to like the ring, so I think it's a good choice.
I think so too. He jumped beautifully. All right, you spend a lot of time down here in the winter. Tell us, what brings you to the Winter Equestrian Festival? Why do you like being here?
Well, I'm behind the curtains a little bit involved in a few things. We have a farm here, and we have did bring some horses, not only to show, also to finally sell, try and find customers, and were helping a few students, not only me, of course, all my colleagues. I've been here before every now and then. I actually was at one point even thinking to maybe come back one time and show myself, but I then thought I leave it better to Christian, bring his best horses here, because again, the field is really, really tough. The competition is great. I just came an hour ago with my car here, and I have to say it's a special feeling coming here on a Saturday night. Great atmosphere. So many cars already have parked outside, and it's really special.
It is. It's a pleasure to have you here. Enjoy tonight.
Thank you very much.
All right, Stephen, back to you.
Thank you very much. Always good to get the thoughts of Ludger Bierbaum and what he thinks. And he thinks there, Christian Kukuk with the prime draw there, is all set and ready to go. Quick rundown. Beasy, you've had a walk of the track. Give me your overall viewpoint of it.
I think it's difficult. It's meaty right from the beginning. You have a big wall right away from the in-gate at fence three, then approach right to the triple combination away from the gate, oxer vertical. And then right away to the water with a big plank right after it, and it's gold, and I think that one is difficult to see at night. And then you have a triple bar to a vertical, typical short four, and then you have quite a distracting double right next to the water with the Liverpool on the backside of A. And then a roll back to the big black skinny, and then coming home you have a wide oxer going into a double, and I think the distance between the oxer and the vertical is quite short. And then of course you always have the big Rolex jump at the end. So I don't know, I think it's quite difficult.
Connie, you had a little look around as well. Sum it up for me in a quick 30 second
rundown. I had a quick run around it as well. Again, the jumps look like they're going to come up fast, and I'd say it'll be a tough test.
Do you think it favours anyone?
I don't think so, honestly. I mean, there's so many good horses and riders there that, you know, they'll figure out the test that's in front of them. I think it's going to be a good class tonight.
So what we've decided, Lauren, essentially, this is a big open field.
I think, you know, the course, I didn't get a chance to walk, but also a big factor is going to be your time allowed.
Yeah.
You know, how much time he allows you to jump a difficult course can suit some horses and not the others.
Yeah, okay, we'll take a look at that. And, I know the time allows 85 seconds, what that means until we see the first horse will not mean a lot to the rest of us, so we'll see. But it's big jumping, it's big money, it's always exciting. Everyone looking forward to it?
Absolutely.
Yes, certainly.
Okay, getting stuck in. Looking forward to tonight's class. And it reminds for me to say thank you to all of you. Connor Swale, good luck to the
thank
Irish
you,
tonight.
Steve.
They're going to get it done?
I believe they will.
You're going to be cheering from the sidelines?
I will, yeah. Relaxing tonight.
Lauren, from your point of view, you get to enjoy as well.
Absolutely. I can't wait to watch. I love to watch the best of the best.
Beasy, you're going to be also in a bit of training mode as well, aren't you?
Yes. We have Daniel Blumen going second. He's trying to, he has an older horse. He's trying to peak towards Paris. So I don't know if he's quite there yet, but we hope he's pretty on form.
L'Adriano.
Yes.
Yeah, he's won big Grand Prix. He's gone well here before now.
Yes.
It might be up his street.
It could be. You know, he's generally been a big jumping horse, you know, the bigger the better, and we'll see if he's back on form tonight.
Absolutely. Well, thank you to all three of you. Enjoy the rest of your evening. Connor, you've taken some money, and you're off again.
Yeah, I've had a good few weeks, actually. It was nice to come in for these few weeks and, like you say, take a bit of money and a few wins. It's always nice to win in Wellington. And I'm off to California again for a few weeks on Monday.
You can't stay out the sunshine.
Yeah, exactly.
Thank you to all three of you. Thank you for joining us here. And we're going to be talking courses as well, because we catch up with Guillaume Georges as well, our course designer, as I say, the man behind the Rio Olympic Games. He's got lots of insights for you on the course and the way that fences ride as well, as we caught up with him. So take a look at this. From all of us, we're going to be back with the main programme with myself and Sir Meredith Michaels Bierbaum in a few minutes' time. But here's Guy with his thoughts on tonight's course.
Course for the last Grand Prix of the season is always an interesting challenge, because we have seen some of the best course designers in the world in action here. It's mostly the same arena, the same canvas that we have to play with. We're gonna have a Grand Prix tonight with 17 efforts, 13 jumps, so there's a lot to play with, a lot of questions to ask. Always with that in mind, that the welfare of the horse, and ask the questions more to the riders than to the horse. I always try to design a course that all the fences are related, even if they are not on a straight line, on a counting stride line. Something that the previous jump is going to affect the next jump, and the rider needs to be very focused, need to do a very good plan when they walk the course. And also the horses need to be concentrating on the job that they have to do. There's a lot of discussion of how the horses see the jumps. I'm a vet. I learned on vet school that the horses don't see colors, but from my riding times and what we see, I'm sure they see, for sure see different of contrast, and maybe they don't see the colors exactly how we see them, but for sure they see differences on the jumps. So when we play with the jumps and we want to make it easier or difficult, we play a little bit like this. The stripe rails are the easier, the solid rails are a little bit more difficult, and horizontally striped rails the most difficult. Also, those sets of jumps that we have here, they have 3 meter, 10 foot is the size of the poles. We have poles here, 12 foot, which is 3.60 meters, and 3 meters, 10 foot. So the narrower the jump is, the poles are lighter, and also the rider needs to be more precise and the horse needs to be more careful. The rider, when he comes in to walk the course, and he of course knows to dump a 5-star, he has to have a really good connection with his horse. The horse rider partnership to jump a 5-star has to have a lot of practice together, and the rider knows his horse. He walks the course, he sees the questions that the course designers are proposing, and then he's going to ride his horse according to that. I'm preparing one set of rails that to use only on week 12, a little bit like the same things the designs I use for Rio. So there's a lot to play with.
I think I found them.
Really?
Making your dog your ring bearer is one way to show your love.
Car part.
It's just a car part, look it.
But delicious Caesar canine cuisine is a better way. From playful puppy to adventurous adult, help keep them healthy. IMS for Life.
With NetJets, travel will always be personal. We do everything it takes to make every flight exceptional. Every single detail of your experience is personalized, just for you. As our standard is not just to meet our definition of perfection, it's to exceed yours.
Our thanks to Jumper App, who are proud to be the official stats provider for the Wellington International Horse Show throughout here for the whole of the winter season. To also our presenting sponsors tonight, Rolex, and from the four Grand Slam tennis tournaments to all the majors in golf, Rolex is a long-term partner of prestigious sporting institutions, events, and exceptional individuals throughout the world. For almost 70 years, Rolex has made a global contribution to equestrianism, demonstrating an enduring commitment to some of the oldest and most revered events within the sport. We also this week caught up with Rolex testimony and hotshot top rider, world number 13, Harry Charles of Great Britain. The young rider, who's only 24 years of age, has already been making a massive impact on the sport. And here's what he had to say when he came here to Wellington for the very first time.
So this is probably, for me, the biggest week of the year so far. First Rolex Grand Prix of the year. Obviously, there are some of the best Grand Prix in the world, so we're very excited for this one. It's like walking into nearly a football game or something on Saturday night, a whole day of anticipation, the build-up. And yeah, this one especially has been building up for 4 weeks, so it's going to be a very exciting competition for everyone. I'm gonna go with Aril in Blue for Saturday night. It was kind of like love at first sight when I first saw her about 3 or 4 years ago. She came to our stable. She's very big, powerful, and super athletic. Since she's been out here these past few weeks, she's really, really impressed us all. That's why she's got the nod for tonight. I'm now 24, will be 25 this year. It's my last year in the under 25 like category. Been very lucky. I've been able to do a lot of cool things in the sport already. We've done an Olympic Games, a World Championships, 2 World Cup finals. We had a medal at the World Championships as well. And hopefully by the end of this year, we'll have 1 more Olympic Games to our CV. Anne Thompson, one of my great owners, supporters for the last few years. She'll be here tonight watching, and you know, also for her, what she's done for my career. I'd love to, you know, give back to her a little bit, give her a good result.
My name is Felicia Wallin and I'm 23 years old. I'm from Sweden, Stockholm, and I work together with Richard Vogel for the last 4 years now. Of course, it's super fun to be by Richie's side. He's always giving his best. He's a really talented rider. And it's nice to see the horses perform, and when they perform good, all the work that you put in pays off kind of in those 2 minutes, 1.5 minutes when they're in the ring. So it's exciting to watch, but the jump ups can be tough to watch sometimes for me, because Richie will always give it all. It was his first 5-star Grand Prix, and it was our first Rolex Grand Prix. I was a bit nervous, but Cipano came in and I saw him already from jump number one. He really put the next gear in, and it's just what I've seen him do since he was a youngster. There was just a whole new level of jumping. He gave it all, and he loves to be competitive. And it was so much fun to watch him give it all in that Grand Prix for the first time on that level. And yeah, I was of course super proud of him. Me and Stefano are close because I obviously looked after him for a long time. And he's a very special horse for me. He's always eager to do his best. And yeah, he's one of many superstars. He is the biggest diva in the barn. You would think it's United, but it's very clearly Cipano. He's the boss in the stable. If you even think about giving someone a cookie, Cipano will be the first one to know. So he knows all the feeding times. He's kind of like the barn manager at this point. Like he knows what's up all the time. He's a funny character. He's a funny guy.
Not always the easiest to ride, but
difficult for me. He hears the loud noises, he knows the bright colors. Not always easy to control. He's very excited, but very active. I mean, I like horses that win. I like athletic horses that are very careful, so it's so fun. We had a lot of prep on us, like the Pan Am Games, because the U.S. had to qualify for the Olympics, so that was kind of a tour guide. We went with a very seasoned team. Landon being a green horse, so I was under a lot of pressure with him, and I thought he rose to the occasion. And I thought he actually grew as the week went on. You know, most of those championships around get more difficult as they go, as the team was just born, so that's sort of how it's built, that everything needs to reach the ones out early on. And by the end, I thought he actually jumped his best, and you know, I'm happy to have a silver individual medal. He was close to winning double gold there, and I'm looking to see if he was on that result. I would say he's still lacking experience on a lot of those. You know, I've seen a horse like him, he's fine, he'll come from the 13, 14, and really knows the ropes, and he's still gain a little bit more than he has now, but that's what he lacks in experience. He needs to put up the ability, so we'll look to have a big battle on the title. You know, the same thing that makes me really excited about all of the horses that I got to ride is that part of the process of building him up to that level is the fun of doing the sport and then seeing it through to the end, and ultimately what it'll become is the journey. So I'm looking forward to it.
Already hearing from some of the best in the sport, with Harry Charles and Kent Farrington, and a few behind the scenes of Richard Vogel of Germany as well. Building up to tonight's Rolex Grand Prix, the best in the world aboard here to Palm Beach. The heat is certainly turned up, and we are nearing the start time of tonight's $500,000 Rolex Grand Prix. Join us after the break.
It is not a machine, though the precision of its mechanics can draw some admiration. Propelled by a unique movement, graced with a singular drive, it has a personality of its own. It was born from a special bond. Crafted over years, with infinite patience and utmost care, listening to every tick, going over every move again and again to build a trust like no other. The kind of trust that allows you to push further, higher. Always. The kind of trust that can transcend any challenge.
Bainbridge is a fully integrated family of real estate companies who have developed and acquired more than 43,000 units representing $7.5 billion in transactions since inception. With over 650 associates nationally, Bainbridge engages in virtually every step of the real estate process, from development and construction, acquisition and disposition, to asset management and third-party property management of multifamily real estate. Bainbridge is the 10th largest multifamily developer and the 14th largest multifamily builder in the United States. Our team of experienced and knowledgeable professionals is devoted to creating exceptional living experiences for all of our residents and building lasting, mutually beneficial relationships with our partners and clients. To learn more, visit www.bainbridgecompanies.com.
Welcome to Palm Beach, the epitome of luxury and elegance. Just a short 20-minute drive away lies Wellington International, home to the prestigious Winter Equestrian Festival. For over four decades, the Winter Equestrian Festival has been synonymous with excellence and tradition. And tonight, the tradition continues with the highly anticipated Rolex Grand Prix. Join us as we witness the world's greatest riders and horses compete for glory in the heart of equestrian excellence. Experience the unparalleled thrill of the Rolex Grand Prix only at the Winter Equestrian Festival in Wellington.
Well, welcome to the Winter Equestrian Festival and the big night of the $500,000 Rolex Grand Prix. Time is ticking away on their perfect clocks, and the night is descending into what is going to be an exciting night ahead. It's the culmination of the Winter Equestrian Festival, 13 weeks of competition, and our thanks to Rolex once again, the official timepiece of the Wellington International and title sponsor of tonight's class as well, and also partner of the four equestrian majors, the Dutch Masters, Arken, the CSIO, Spruce Meadows Masters, and CHI Geneva as well, that make up the Rolex Grand Slam of Jumping, considered within the sport to be the ultimate challenge. And our thanks to Defender as well as part of our lineup tonight as we team up with the very best names in the sport here as part of this Rolex $500,000 Grand Prix, and in partnership too with the USEF and US Equestrian as well, bringing you all the competitions throughout the season and part supported by each of those. So our thanks to them as we get set for a big night, and alongside me is the lady that's perfect to talk it through with me tonight, is Rolex Testimony, the only lady rider to be world number one, 3 times World Cup winner, gold medalist in the World Championships, Meredith Michaels-Bibam. Good evening.
Good evening.
Looking forward to this?
Oh yes, it's going to be a great event. Rolex always hosts an unbelievable event for horse and rider, and we have some of show jumping's heroes here tonight.
Certainly do, and it's been an amazing season so far. Looking how this plays out, we've got the world number one and the world number two. We've got 5 of the world's top 10 here this week, but Henrik von Eckermann with us here, the world number one. Ben Mayer, the world number two. It's going to be pretty hard fought.
Yeah, I mean, I'm really impressed with the field tonight. There are a lot of Europeans here. A lot of Europeans were here in Florida competing the entire time. So it's going to be a really international field. Some of the best horses in the world. We have an Olympic year this year.
Yep.
So everybody's prepping for that. So I think you're going to see some great sport here tonight.
And the great thing is you've got a foot in both Europe and America, so you can give us the full coverage.
Definitely.
And Danny Woolman is going to be down on the floor with us as well, catching up with riders. Danny, what's it feeling like down there tonight?
Stressful down here. Everyone is a little bit nervous. They say the course is quite big, very challenging, but I think people are excited. They're ready. You know, they're a little bit nervous about some of the tall verticals, some width of the oxers, the distances, and of course, curious how that time allowed will play out, because I think that will play a big role in what distances, what numbers the people do, and how many clears we're going to see.
Well, looking forward to who that is, as you say. It gets nervous down there. You've been through this atmosphere before. How do you control that?
Well, that's an interesting question. You know, I think these riders have a lot of experience, you know, all of them. And so they know this feeling, and they have their pre-game routine, which they go through, you know, walking the course, discussing it with either co-riders or trainers. But I always remember that I started to get relaxed when I got on my horse. I had the butterflies in my stomach when I was walking the course, nervous. But when I got on my trusty steed, whether that was Shutterfly at his best or Checkmate, I started to relax and realize this is a partnership. This is something, you know, I'm doing together with an animal. You know, you have to have that sort of bond in order to get over those fences. So you really got to put your mind in the right spot.
We've looked at this, an exciting field, 40 riders in all. I've mentioned the world's number one and two there, Henrik von Eckermann and Ben Mayer. We've had lots of discussion about this. It looks very open. The Irish have been on top form. People like Shane Sweetenham in here. What are your thoughts?
Well, it's really interesting. There are a lot of great horses, like we said, and there are one or two that are maybe not quite on the map, like haven't won the 5-star event yet, you know, like a young rider like a Natalie Dean, for instance. I love her horse. She's been doing amazingly. She's had a great circuit. You mentioned Shane Sweetenham with that great horse that he's been building up over the last few years. So we have the superstars, you know, the Kent Farrington, McLean Wars. We have two great riders from Germany, and Richie Fogel, who's already won a 5-star this year here, and Christian Kukuk, who's had an amazing last year riding with my brother-in-law, Ludger Baerbaum. So it'll be really interesting to see whether it's really that old-time experience that comes through, or maybe a new star, a new combination.
And people like McLean Ward riding on a horse that hasn't necessarily been and done this with him yet, a horse called Ilex, adds a little bit of spice to this.
I think that's actually a very interesting name you've brought up, because that's a real new horse for McLean, but it's an Olympic hope for him.
Yeah.
So this is its first real test. Everybody's going to get to see it tonight under the lights and see how it does. I mean, he's testing it himself to see, is that going to be my horse for the games? So it'll be fun to watch.
Christian Kukuk, you mentioned there, he'll actually go last because it's reverse order of qualifying from the qualifier earlier on this week. He actually didn't win it. Connor Swale actually won
it.
But Connor's decided that he's not jumping tonight. So Christian's going to get prime draw. That is definite advantage.
Without a doubt, you know, in this kind of event, it really helps to be able to watch your colleagues ride. You can see the time allowed is always a factor, and you can really see that by watching a couple of people go first. And also, I think some of the lines here tonight are tricky. There's a little bit of a question of distance, of how many strides you're going to do. And if you can watch, it helps. You know, that there's no question about it. On the other hand, I've seen often in these events, the first person goes in there and nails it because they have their plan, they have their focus. They're not distracted by what the others are doing. So, you know, it'll be interesting. We'll see.
It'll be very interesting indeed. Laura Kraut is in there with a horse that she jumped a few weeks ago into the Nations Cup as well, Biscetta Biscuit.
Yes. Again,
a little less experienced horse, but jumped superbly.
Well, Laura has just, I mean, been the backbone of the American team for so many years, and she has medals to prove it. But like you said, this is a new horse. I've seen it jump. It's tremendously talented.
Yeah.
But this is definitely a challenge, probably the most challenging course until now that she's jumped. The 1-5 star she's jumped before.
Yes.
But yeah, I think it's, again, it's a new combination, and it's a playing field here. She'll see how that mare does. And there will be questions for someone like that who has a new horse. How many strides should I do? And, you know, that's always a little bit challenging and easier if you have a horse you've been with for many years and you can go out there and make a plan and you're certain that that's how you should ride the course.
You're not into unknown territory. You're going to be flying the flag for the ladies, I'm sure, tonight as well.
Yes, of course. Always.
So a terrific field lies ahead. As I say, we could sit here all night and go through all 40 of them. It looks a wide open field for tonight's $500,000 Rolex Grand Prix. We're going to be taking you through that with a few guests along the way as well. Danny Woolman's also going to be down in the warm-up catching up with the riders as we go. We're looking forward to a big night of competition here. It's the culmination of the season for the Winter Equestrian Festival as well, and we're going to be building up to that. We're back very shortly after this break.
Doors lead us to places we've never been. Your dedicated Fidelity advisor can help you open those doors. They can help you create a retirement income plan designed to balance growth and guaranteed income, and provide access to specialists who help with estate planning to look out for future generations. So you're not just growing and protecting your wealth, you're sharing it. Because doors were meant to be opened.
Thank you.
Well, welcome back, and looking forward to an amazing night of competition ahead for this Rolex $500,000 Grand Prix. An exciting night, and our thanks to Rolex once again, the official timepiece of Wellington International, and a wonderful supporter here. And they continue with their Rolex testimonies as well, and many of the great names in the sport. Our thanks to Fidelity Investments as well, a continued sponsor and our presenting sponsor of the Week 5 Grand Prix as part of our list of five-star competitions for the night. And thanks to the USCF network and to US Equestrian as well as part of our supporting team for all of the events here. And great to have that partnership there as we take a look at the course for tonight's big Rolex $500,000 Grand Prix. Brought to you by Fidelity Investments, our animation, and Meredith Michaels-Bierbaum alongside me, who's taken a look at the track. We're going to give the simplified version of Guillaume Georges' course. And Meredith, what have we got?
Well, it definitely starts off very seriously here. You have one, two, and then a turn away from the in-gate to a wall, which it could be considered a spooky wall. These horses have a lot of experience at this level, so I don't expect any problem with that. But then it gets serious as you go to the triple combination here, the Rolex triple combination, double oxer vertical. So that's early on for a triple combination in this course. So you have to be on your game. The horses have to be really ready to go right from the beginning. That's 4ABC. Then you kind of go around here. You have a nice approach to the water, so the water is always a difficult jump, but you have a very good way to get there, but a really big plank afterwards and a distance problem of either six long strides or seven very short, a bending line here to another oxer over a Liverpool. So you've just jumped the open water, had to go forward, and then he's built an oxer very careful over a Liverpool. Then you come to the triple bar we just saw, and a steady four strides to a vertical. And this, I think, is the trickiest part of the course. It's sort of a bending line, heads you towards the water, but then you have to jump, instead of jumping the water, obviously, you have to jump this combination vertical with a Liverpool on the backside, very short one stride to a very wide oxer. And then he has you roll back on this interesting skinny jump that has a lot of rails, which is unusual for us. Most of the course designers use three rails when they want it to be very careful, but there are like seven or eight rails on that jump. I'm curious to see how they jump it. And the last line is the double there. Again, a big combination and a steady five strides to a very big Rolex Oxer to finish. It's a really wide jump.
Well, first is on course, and that is for Australia, Scott Keach. Time allowed of 85 seconds around the track here tonight. And as the fading light goes out, we welcome in Scott, who jumped superbly here just a few weeks ago as part of the Nations Cup show there. Has an early fence down for the rider who's competed in Olympics before now, both disciplines, in eventing and in jumping too. And wall comes up early on here, Meredith, and then we start to really get into some interesting lines with this Rolex line here.
Yeah, here we see early rails at number two, the middle of the triple. I know that Scott's been a veteran for the Australian team for many years. And this horse, he jumped beautifully the other day in the qualifier. But you could see early on he was just not on his game. He was a little deep to number two, and then the middle of the triple got him. It's an interesting horse, though. He has a lot of jump. He, like I said, was great in the qualifier. But this, you can see, is a technical course. Here's this turn to this double I was mentioning. And the short one, he did that very, very well. And then he's going to roll back here on the skinny jump with all the rails. He jumped that well. I think they will jump that well. It's unusual to see that.
It's a little bit of an almost old-fashioned fence there,
yeah,
isn't it?
Yeah, I would say that is accurate. And then here, a little forward coming out of that double. And then that's a very steady five to the last.
84.39, so we're inside the time, finishing on 16 for Australia and Scott Keach and Noble de la Chapelle are first to go as part of this Rolex Grand Prix here tonight.
Yeah, I mean, that's a horse for the future for him. It's a big, scopey horse. He looked a little starstruck, I must say.
Yeah.
Maybe he needs a couple more rounds of this level to be ready for this challenging course.
course.
One that's been there and done it is Daniel Blumen now with the over-the-top stables, L'Adriano Z, representing Israel. Daniel, who with this horse has won the Rolex Grand Prix in Rome before now, won at the Hampton Classic, won here in Wellington. In fact, he won this class, the season-ending Grand Prix, back in 2012, as we've talked to him about that before, a little bit younger then, from that point of view. And that was with Sancha LLS going back from there. And talking to BZ Madden tonight, she's also helping him tonight as well with L'Adriano's superb horse. It's got loads of experience, big jump from what we've seen plenty of times before. Meredith, what do you think?
I mean, this is a combination that's done it all. I remember watching him win the Rolex Grand Prix in Rome 2019. He was just been outstanding with this horse. So this will be interesting because this pair, you know, have the experience together to know to walk the course, to make a plan, to stick with the plan. So let's see how he handles this. That was the 7 strides to start, which is a nice flowing distance. And he goes quickly around here for the time allowed to the wall. So he does a steady 8 strides coming into the triple. Jumps the triple easily.
Nicely handled. I mean, it's a horse that's always got loads of jumping ability. It's always just been about pace, really, hasn't it?
Well, this is, yeah, like I said, great. Oh, he had to ride the water strongly, which he knew, and then got him back for the length. That was really good. Very good over that oxer.
Come back on that. It was a really plain colored poles on that palm tree fence, and yeah, then into this line again. He's mixing it up with the colors.
Triple bar, steady 4. Here's that bending line. Oh, he's doing great. He's really jumping this beautifully. He's got this rollback and then the last line.
Time allowed of 85 seconds. He should be okay with this. It's the double and then the Rolex to finish. Looking good so far. Time's not a problem. And
great.
There we go.
There's our first play around. It doesn't surprise me at all. That combination has just been successful around the world.
Very nicely done, and 81.34 is the time. Daniel Blumen and L'Adriano Z. Big L jumps clear, no problem at all. They handle it fantastically.
Yeah, this is the fun part for Daniel. Now he gets to sit back and watch all his colleagues, you know, fight their way around the course, and he can sit back for a minute, get a breath of fresh air, and think about the jump off.
Well, it is Daniel Blumen then to give us clear rounds at number 1. Take us on to our next now, and it is going to be on to Adrian Sterlich and the Starlight Farms of Greenwich, Connecticut's Aurisia van Heert Zuid-Puitenland. And again, horse a little bit less experienced from that point of view here with Adrian, but has jumped several of the 5 stars so far this season as well. She's got wonderful experience. She was a gold medalist from the World Championships in 2018 as well. And now really building up a new string of horses from this point of view, and could be one to watch out for tonight.
Yeah, this should be interesting. Adrian had tremendous success with her wonderful mare, Crystalline, under the tutelage of McLean Ward. Now she's working together with Jerome Dubeldam, and this is a new horse for her. It's a very impressive jumper. I don't think they have the experience at this level quite yet, but it'll be interesting to see how they handle it. You know, Daniel just made it look so easy. But it's interesting also, Stephen, you know, some of these courses, they jump better than they walk.
Yeah.
Or vice versa, you know. I think a lot of the riders were impressed with this course, thought it was very, very difficult, but we'll see, you know, time will tell.
Does that help you mentally? Does that actually, if you've got a really tough course, just feel you keep it, you know, on your game? Just unfortunately has that fence down.
Yeah, you know, first to comment on that rail, I think it's always hard to first have to ride over the open water.
Yeah.
And then have to jump a fence over a Liverpool water, because the horse is automatically thinking when they see the blue again that they have to go forward, and then there's a tall jump. A square oxer like that, like the course designer has set there. So that's always a test. So I could see that horse went a little bit forward into the front rail there. And then the steady 4 strides got her. But but still a pretty solid round for a new combination.
Yeah, finishing on a score of 8.84.22, so just inside the time there for the combination of Adrian Sternix and Origia from that point of view. As you say, just really starting to get some experience with that pairing together this season overall, and again, some good results. They've had a few timefalls here and there, and now just starting to put the polish on it.
Yeah, that looks solid. I think she'll have fun with that horse. I mean, the horse made two forward faults, but they weren't bad faults. They were faults that I think she can prevent in the future.
Now, 21-year-old Hallie Grimes is next up, and Hallie here with the ride of Carolina Bullmore for the Can We Keep It LLC of Texas. Rider came fantastically through into the equitations and then into the under 25s, and now certainly making her way in the bigger stadiums as well. This is actually a horse that was former winner here with Ashley Bond from that point of view, and Hallie now set up her own stable. She spent many years training with John Brennan and Missy Clark, and has been over to Europe as well, gained some good experience, and really forging her way now in the world.
Yeah, I remember watching this mare win with
Ashley Bond.
Yeah, Ashley Bond on the grass, the Rolex Grand Prix on the grass where we had it, and it was just so impressive how she jumped. She was a green mare then, but of just a fabulous jumper. And I think Haley's been doing really nicely with her. I know she was not an easy horse to ride. I remember Ashley telling me, difficult in the mouth, a little bit, and you can see there where she was fighting her after the water, but just a natural, talented jumper.
Now, triple bar to this vertical with, again, plain, if you like, looking poles, gold poles almost, a little bit different. Again, looks a little bit like the sand that you're jumping off, and unfortunately there comes as well.
You know, she backed off nicely at the A part, the first part of the combination, and then she just didn't have the momentum to get out over the Oxa. That was really too bad. Like I said, I think the mare is difficult. You know, she's so talented, but she's not an easy ride. She's difficult in the mouth, and you could see that Haley just didn't feel comfortable finishing on that last line, knowing she already had two rails down, she would be out of the ribbons. So she's going to save her for another day.
Absolutely, yeah. And so decided to retire there for Hallie Grimes and Caroline of Bullmore. Daniel Blumen giving us the one clear so far with L'Adriano Z. Very early stages of this Rolex $500,000 Grand Prix here tonight. Jordan Coyle of Ireland, terrific run for him here in the last few weeks as well. He won the 150 series just on the Saturday night just a couple of weeks ago here. Comes in strong as well with a long list of wins with Shakolina this time. Jumped to week five, back onto the five-star, as we call it here, back onto the Fidelity Grand Prix there back in the early part of February. Jumped a nice round there and really hasn't, again, had the two had the experience together. He was winning last Saturday night with four gold. But we've seen this horse a few times now. It's a horse with lots of scope, lots of ability. It's got Grand Prix horse written on it. It has now just got to get the mileage.
Yeah, I think it's funny you pointed out Jordan. He's had an amazing circuit. He's done extremely well, and a lot of his success was on his other horse, which couldn't be more different than this horse. A little teeny for pleasure horse, got four gold, and this one is big and heavy and just scopey, but totally different. So it's interesting how riders can get along with different kinds of horses. Oh, he was in the water there. But they couldn't be more different, his two types of horses, and yet he can have success with both of them. It looked like the horse just kind of didn't jump the water. He looked like he came fine, but just kind of was a little casual about it. Sort of a twisty, turny course, you can see. I really think that is going to be the hardest line on the course. But it's sort of everything leads up to that, you know, having to jump the open water early on, and then he has a couple of Liverpools underneath jumps, and like I was pointing out before, that's always difficult for a horse to gauge the difference.
overall. Going to leave the Rolex Oxa there at 82.85. They're getting there okay for time so far, but it is 12 there, so two down and a foot in the water for Jordan Coyle this time with Chacolino. Like I say, not too many big rounds behind them yet. Here's another look at the water, Meredith, but it was no doubting the splash.
You know, maybe he came a little bit deep, maybe he came a little bit under tempo, maybe he needed to give the horse a little bit of a stronger ride, a little bit more speed to get over that water. He looked like he thought the horse would jump it well, and he just, you know, he just put a foot in the water. That was too bad.
Paul O'Shea now, fellow Irishman to compete and also Grand Prix winner this season as well. So it is Paul with Emerald van Voorhoff, four-star winners this season. But if you've been here in Wellington, you'll know that, you know, the different standards, if you like, toughness of the course is four-star, then five-star, which this is. Think of your hotels. Five-star is the biggest and the best. But the four-stars here are pretty close to a five-star. So this isn't a big leap for this combination to then do this again. Paul, who's been a world championship rider for Ireland and actually went very well in a big Grand Prix with this horse in Tryon back in October as well. So he comes in with form, and actually talking to some riders earlier on, he could be one that just comes out of the pack here.
Yeah, you know, Paul's been with this horse. It's his longtime partner, so they know each other.
Little push at the wall, yeah. But it stays.
It stayed up. That's good for him. Looks like he got a little up. He got lucky at the wall, but there, it just looked like the horse didn't finish the middle of the oxer. He didn't quite get the width. He came down a little on the back pole of that oxer. So that was a 7 strides to the plank. We've seen both now, 6 and 7 strides there.
What do you think is going to be the standout part of the course from what you've seen so far?
Well, right now it's really interesting because it's sort of catching everybody everywhere. You know, the triple ride's difficult. The water has posed a problem. The Liverpool in front of the in gate, and then that I find really tricky line there with the bending line to the double. So so far it's looked like, you know, aside from Daniel, who made it look so easy with his longtime partner, it looks tricky. It looks like there are problems everywhere, and it's going to be an interesting evening.
Well, there's lots there to get your head around, and one who has already is Daniel Blumen, and he is down with Danny.
All right, I'm here with Daniel. Daniel, congratulations. Well done. How'd it feel out there?
Thank you. Yeah, it feels great, you know, to have the chance to jump L'Adriano in this type of class still after so many years, and definitely to jump clear. You know how it feels to jump clear in this stadium, so... yeah, very happy.
Well, congratulations. It was wonderful.
Thank you very much.
All right, Stephen, back to you.
Kelly Cruciotti van der Veen now, and Kelly with Gideon for the Serenity Show Stables of here in Wellington. A horse by Super Trooper Dines, which actually was a horse that McLean Ward rode the latter part of his career. Again, a step up for this horse, unfortunately, the first fence down, but the rider who's competed at the World Cup Finals in 2019. And this is a 10-year-old, so again, just starting to get into this, Meredith.
Yeah, Kelly's done a nice job coming along. I know she's been selected for the three-star developing riders tour that's going to go over to Europe soon. But you could see, you know, she just has had some trouble right from the beginning. The first jump was down. You know, that's always so discouraging for a rider. When you have a course of, you know, this nature and you have the first jump down, boy, it's a long way around. But you can see she's not going to give up. She's going to keep going. She needs to get the experience. This horse needs to get the experience. So even though she has 12 faults already, she's going to keep it going, see if she can, you know, bring him home safely and get some experience for her up-and-coming tour in Europe.
And you've been here and done this. I mean, even the great ones, the Shutterflies, there had to be those times where you did classes and went, okay, we've just got to find out what we've got and build a partnership.
Yeah, you know, I mean, I even tell my daughter who I'm helping now training, you know, if you're not winning, you've got to be training. You know, there's all of a sudden maybe you're not going to win a ribbon in the class or you're not getting prize money, but then you have a, you know, another objective. So you can see she's giving the horse a nice pat. She's actually delighted. The horse has gone around safely, shown that it's very, very brave, and she knows she can improve upon that performance. So you're either riding or you're training.
Yeah, absolutely. 16 jumping one time, total of 17 there for Kelly Cruciotti van der Veen. But as you say, I mean, that is a pairing I would be looking for later on into this year and this time next year.
Yeah, I think she'll be delighted to go off that with confidence to Europe this summer.
A man who's got plenty of experience is Rodrigo Pessoa of Brazil. Like you, a three-time winner of the World Cup Finals and also World Championship and Olympic champion back in Athens. And he's back in the groove now with this horse as well. This is Major Tom next, owned by the Artemis Equestrian Farm of here in Wellington, owned by Christian Jim Clark. And the horse he rode for a team bronze at the Pan Am Games last year and also rode the round that sealed it for Paris for the Olympics as well for the Brazilians, to a super jumping horse. Really looking forward to seeing this one.
Yeah, this is a great horse. Rodrigo discovered him as a young horse and has brought him along so nicely. He had a podium finish in Aachen with this horse last year, and it's just a great talented jumper. Oh, did a little bit of a funny jump over that B part of the combination, but Rodrigo rode it really strongly, helped him get through. You could see the horse shifted and did a funny jump there, but didn't give up. You know, that's where you need a horse to fight for you too. They need to be fighters, so they have to be on your side. They have to be willing to give everything. You know, this is definitely, you know, one of the tougher tracks, this horse's jump for sure. But you can see, oh, that was too bad. That was just kind of didn't finish the jump behind. He sort of let his hind end sort of drag a little bit there. You can see there are no free jumps on this course.
No.
I mean, it just, things are coming up everywhere a little differently maybe than they walked, in fact.
But everyone is out there testing you, as you say. There's nothing that's a giveaway. Going to finish on just the four there at 81.76, just on four faults for Rodrigo Pessoa, and Major Tom goes into second place so far. Again, you wouldn't be too satisfied with the round, but you'd be kicking yourself that you're not in the jump off.
Yeah, I mean, Rodrigo for sure will be a little bit disappointed, but I think he'll be satisfied that the horse did a good job. You could see Rodrigo really had to give him a strong ride. So, you know, the track is tough tonight. I mean, this horse jumped, you know, clear in Aachen. So you can see we have a real track out there tonight.
Luis Fernando Larrazabal now of Venezuela, also part of the Pan Am Games last year as well, with Victoria Hurtimata's Condara. She's actually ridden this horse as well. She rides internationally for Panama, but she's handed over the ride now to Luis. In fact, he was 15th place at the Pan Am Games last year in Santiago. Individual fourth at the Central American Games, team bronze there last year as well, so certainly had a good year. And actually was third in the Hampton Classic Grand Prix, and I'm going to say it was on four faults because there were only two clears in it. It was a tough track up there, and it shows they've got the ability over a big course. So this is one that could just come out of the pack tonight.
Yeah, you know, what I've seen of this horse is it's a very careful horse, and he's a very competitive rider, so it'll be interesting to see how he handles this. The triple ride is definitely a little harder than I thought, actually, walking it. But anytime you have the triple, it's 4ABC away from the in gate, double oxer. I mean, you know, that's serious. Like I said, you got to be on your game. You can't be, you know, even a little bit casual riding into that combination.
So Luis, unfortunately, getting trouble in the combination there. So Bell goes, just going to rebuild.
You know, if that combination were to be later in the course, the horse has more momentum, the adrenaline is pumping higher, and it's maybe easier to jump. But the course designer has put it early on and also has turned you away from the in-gate, put the wall there, which maybe gets the horses a little backed off perhaps, or even, you know, just doesn't allow you to have a lot of momentum at that point to be ready for that double ox or triple combination.
Very interesting. Just the one clear so far, that coming from Daniel Blumen and Ladriano. So we're also getting reverse order of qualifying. We had a qualifying class earlier on this week, and so those that go last are best in qualifying. That's going to be Christian Kukuk that comes up a little later on of our 40 in this. Now Nasser now of Egypt and based here in the United States, riding the Evergate Stables, Igor van de Vitemore, the horse that he rode at the Olympic Games, and a horse he's got a great partnership with. Olympics, World Championships, also won the $1 million Queen's Cup at Calgary last year as well, back in the summer as well at Spruce Meadows. And so he's coming in with a different set of ingredients here, a little like Daniel Blumen, experienced horse, experienced rider. This is where they get tested.
Yeah, you know, Niall has a lot of confidence with this horse. I think he was second in the five-star a couple weeks ago.
He was, yeah.
And I always love watching Niall, you know, because we have a personal connection. He came to Germany when he was 11 years old with his family, and he rode with us. So I've been sort of watching his career move forward, and he's really become an amazing five-star rider, a really important part of the Egyptian team. So it's fun for me to watch him. But like you said, he has a lot of experience with this horse, especially here in this ring under these lights. Boy,
that's
got
splashing.
Water. I'm just so surprised we're seeing faults all over the course tonight. No free jumps here tonight. It's interesting. You would, if you ask some riders, would they rather ride in open water with a related distance to the water, or rather have a long run and, you know, yeah, no distance that, like this one here tonight, where you could decide on your own the speed and the, you know, approach? I'm not sure. I always thought that it's easier when it's not a related distance, when you could, you know, decide the speed you were going to the water, how many strides. But you can see it's a pretty wide water tonight, and obviously they're having trouble getting across it.
Finishing on the 482.14, so just the one down into third place so far for Niall Nasser, just a little back from Rodrigo Pessoa. He was on 81.76 with Major Tom. Daniel Blumen, of course, with the clear, just a little touch there, but here into the Rolex triple combination for Niall, athletically through that without too much trouble at all. There's wife Jen just watching as well, and hard to watch too.
That's fun to see everybody watching and cheering the kiss and cry, right?
So nerves will be down there on the kiss and cry once again for Kendra Clarissia Brinkop of Germany, the 29-year-old rider with the Stepex Stables in time. And she's been with us for the last few weeks here at the Winter Equestrian Festival, and Stepex team often send a very good group of riders, and she is certainly one of those who stepped up very nicely. She's been placed already with a horse called Do It Easy or into the early weeks here. She was top five in a recent Grand Prix in Paris as well. She's a really good looking rider, isn't she?
She's an excellent rider. She comes from Germany. She, as you said, rides for the Stepex Stables. Before that, she was with Marcus Enning. She's an excellent rider. She's one of Germany's best women riders, without a doubt.
Now, just the one clear at this stage. So, again, your strategy starts to wonder of where your full faults are going to sit, I suppose, at this point, too. But you wouldn't expect a long list of clears tonight.
No, it doesn't look like it. I want to comment on how beautifully she rode the water there. You could see she, you know, committed around the corner. She saw a really good stride, and the horse just jumped it beautifully. She's having a very good round. She set the horse up beautifully for that double, took time. She's trying to make sure she's on the time now with a short turn back here. And she's trying to keep it together for this last line.
Looking good. Looking
fabulous.
Very good for the
wow.
German rider. So
great ride. Look how happy she is. I mean, that's a big accomplishment for her. She's had a great season here, and this is a way to finish it off.
Looking very good. Absolutely. Kendra Clarissa Brinkhoff, and in time, perfectly in time, 81 seconds on the clock, 81.21 to be exact. That's not a problem. The clear ad is definitely the good solution to all of this. And Kendra is making her presence felt here tonight. And there we go. Oh, yes, that's what it feels like for those over on the Kiss and Cry. All the team there supporting.
That was great. That was so beautifully ridden. You could see she really gave the horse time, and all of the different challenges around the course, she gave the horse time to get off the ground, to know where he was, not to rush him, but still stayed in the time allowed. You know, that's a challenge, you know, to stay in the time allowed, but also to give your horse time off the ground and not rush him.
On to Jimmy Tirano now, and Jimmy, very good result here yesterday in the big qualifying class there as well, finished in second spot. Different ride though this time, Chewbacca HCC, big jumping horse for Iceloo Incorporated in the Jet Show Stables of here in Wellington, Florida. Jimmy, huge experience, multiple appearances at World Cup finals, Grand Prix wins, long list of those through a well-established career, including the Rolex Grand Prix in Central Park as well. Another big jumping horse that's now really being tested at this level by Claramo, 12 years of age, absolutely perfectly ready to go, and in the air, as we can see at fence two.
Yeah, I must say that was really impressive, Jimmy, yesterday, what he had to do to qualify. He was first to go in that qualifier. Oh, he just squeaked over that wall. This horse has got tremendous jump, but is very hard to regulate. You can see from his size and his stride that Jimmy has a hard time getting him together. You know, he has a hard time making a shorter stride. When he was short to the wall, the horse sort of lurched over it here. The horse has a difficult mouth, all the ability in the world, but extremely difficult to ride. But I was saying, Jimmy was really impressive yesterday, first to go in that qualifier, and he laid down the trip to qualify himself for this. I mean, you know, it's not just about tonight, you have to get in tonight. You can see how slow that four stride was for him. This horse is just enormous, and to fit him in these spaces is not so easy.
Just sitting on the four at the moment for Jimmy again, looking at potential prize money, if they can keep it at that. Whoa.
It's really hard when the distance is short for this horse to get his whole body out of the way. Jimmy did a good job. That was a very good job.
Yeah, 86.23. He's going to leave him with a couple of time as well. Four jumping, two time, total of six into fifth place so far for Jimmy Tirano. Chewbacca HCC. Meredith, let's sum it up.
Well, you can see here, like, it's so difficult. If the striding is coming up at all backward, that the horse has to sort of make this awkward jump where he lurches back and then forward, you know, it's probably hard to sit on, even uncomfortable for Jimmy. So, I mean, he did a good job. I think the horse is great, you know, from scope, but definitely would not be my kind of ride.
The world number one, Henrik von Eckermann and Khaleesi for the DeFour Stables, certainly adding to the field this year. So we bring in the world number one and number two, Ben Mayer, to come a little bit later on. Khaleesi second in the Grand Prix qualifier last week in Ocala. He's here just for a couple of weeks. This is his second appearance here in Wellington. And a wonderful rider that has got the list of everything right now. He's won the World Cup finals, he's world champion, he's got Olympic team gold, he's got World Championship team gold, European team gold. All of that is great, but you're out there again and having to prove it.
Yeah, well, you know, this is, I think, a relatively new horse at this level. I mean, Henrik's been riding her for a while, but I think for her to be jumping at this level is relatively new. I haven't seen him do her in a class of this caliber many times. But Henrik's, you know, number one in the world. He's done it all with his great King Edward. He has the experience. And so this is part of the game, bringing on the next one, trying to bring along a string, create a string for yourself, backup horses for different jobs, different shows. Some horses are better on sand, some on grass, indoors. Some are better indoors, or some are better outdoors. So you've got to bring, if you want to stay number one in the world, you've got to have a good string of horses for all these different classes around the world.
And he's doing a heck of a job of it so far.
Yeah, he really is. You know, Henrik's amazing. He's a fighter. He's always giving his best. He does a lot of. Oh, that was just a
so close.
Yeah, he'll be disappointed with that rail. I mean, he had a great round. She looked like she just got a little bit flat, maybe all the oxers that she had to stretch across, and then she had to back off there. She was maybe a little green, just kept the forward momentum there and had that rail.
So let's have another look at it. It just starts to get a little bit tight in here.
Yeah, you know, you could see how short that got for her. She went really forward of the oxer to get the width, and then the distance was just way too short for her to be able to clear it.
Well, it is close for Henrik van Eckermann, but not close enough as he finishes on four, goes into third so far with Khaleesi. But again, frustration not being clear, but the horse has jumped a terrific round, has jumped two superb rounds in the last few weeks. And as you say, as a newer one to this level, they can also put a good tick in the box.
Yeah, I think Henrik will be relatively happy with that. You know, I know he'd want to be in the jump off for sure, but I mean, that was a really solid round with a new horse at this level.
Lily Keener now of the USA, the Chansonnette Farmer, New York's Argan de Belliard. Terrific run that she had here just last week. In fact, she won the Grand Prix qualifier and the Grand Prix. And for the horse that she rode at the World Championships back in 2022, she won the five-star Grand Prix in Monterrey previously in Mexico and last year in Ottawa as well. Lovely combination and great sim back in it. Lovely stylish rider to watch, Meredith.
Oh yeah, she is a stylish rider. I mean, she looks beautiful on the horse. She did extremely well as a junior rider in the equitation. She's extremely accurate. Lily's had a great circuit. She has a whole bunch of new horses, old horses, and a great string. I mean, she has put together a string for herself, as we were just talking about, at all sorts of levels. And I think it's really exciting to watch her come along into the highest ranks now. That was a heartbreaking rail as well.
Just almost floated to the ground. It was just, as you say, a light one from that point of view. Just on the four then for Lily. A few of those coming out four faults so far. Henrik van Eckermann, Rodrigo Pessoa, Nal Nassar, Jimmy Serrano. He had a little bit of time to add to it as well. She's going to be okay for time. Yeah,
she's going to be disappointed with that. It was a really good round for this pair. Just a shame. You can see it's really easy to just have one down. There's now quite a lineup of four faults.
Just on the four there, and so Lily Keenan finishes on the four. We're going to go down to Danny, who's with the lady who's also produced here, Kendra Clarissa Brinkop.
What does it mean to actually jump clear in Wellington? It's your first time here.
To be honest, it's incredible. I think I still cannot believe that. Under the lights, first time here, first time also with the mare, the Rolex Grand Prix, so I'm absolutely delighted with my mare and, yeah, of course, very excited for the jump off.
Well, good luck and thanks so much. All right, back to you, Stephen.
Well, looking good. Thank you, Danny. And so we've seen the world number one now, the world number two, Ben Mayer of Great Britain, the Olympic champion, won that with Explosion W today with Dallas Vegas Batty. Superb run that you'd expect to have as world number two to stay up there, from World Cup wins over the Windsor, including Verona and at home in London as well, to two Grand Prix wins so far this season here in Wellington, including the Nations Cup just a few weeks ago. And Meredith, you've been at the top. What makes this man so special too?
Oh, well, Ben is outstanding. You know, he's an outstanding rider. He's been an outstanding rider for many years. He's been a major team player for Great Britain. And he had not only a fabulous horse in Explosion, he has an amazing string of young horses coming along that he's discovered himself, picked out, brought along. I mean, that's all part of the game. And that's what makes him as good as he is. Not just one great horse, but a whole bunch of them. And you can see this mare here tonight. I really like this horse. And he's brought her along. And she's so talented. But Ben has patience. He has the program. He has the management. He has the team around him. He has all the ingredients.
Again, he's just got the accuracy there, too.
Yeah. I mean, this is a beautiful round. I just hope for him down this last line. I mean, I love watching this horse. What a beautiful type, an athletic, thoroughbred type mare. It just jumps it so easily. Look at that.
Ben Mayer getting the job done. 80.99 over that last fence. Fence 13, a big stretch across there, 1 meter 75 in width there at the final fence there, and not a big surprise as Ben Mayer gives us a clear. He's a previous winner of this Rolex Grand Prix, won back in 2016. That was on a horse called Serena on that occasion. Now with Tilly to take a spin at it tonight. So the world number one out, but the world number two is in there and very much in the mix.
That was a great round, very exciting.
Elise Oka now, the High Hopes Farms, Jelvira to go next. Now, you can probably tell me quite a bit about this one.
Yeah, you know, Lisi is a student of ours. She trains with my husband, Marcus, and I'm really excited to see her ride here tonight. She had a clear round with the time fault the other day in the five-star Grand Prix with this mare. She's coming along great with her. She was on the winning team last year in Denmark with her, and even won a Grand Prix in Drammen in Norway. So now I'm just going to keep my fingers crossed and see how it goes.
Yeah, she's had a really good time. She was on the US team just a few weeks ago in Abu Dhabi. Really good start. I mean, looks confident and strong.
Yeah, the mare is a great jumper. Lisi is a really accurate rider. Oh gosh, just got a little backed off there in the middle of the triple, which is interesting because in the qualifier there was a double, a Rolex double, and she had the back bar of the Oxer going into that double, so I don't know if it's the green and yellow that has backed the mare off a little, but you could see she got backed off at the water a little bit too.
That's gone as well. Again, she's really just getting into the groove for this level this season, isn't she? Because, as you say, she jumped some terrific rounds in Nations Cups last year, and this is now the next step of it.
Yeah. You know, it just looked like the mare was a little backed off in the beginning of the course. I said that challenging start with that triple coming so early on looked like it surprised the two of them, and then the open water.
Coming home with 16 includes a foot in the water there. Clears the last, no trouble at all. One of the widest on the course. 16 the score, and it is going to be 84.63 as a time there for Elise Oka and Gelvira this time. Looking good, but unfortunately not quite to be today. But as I say, this is going to be another, like you say, it's also the training element.
Yeah, you know, it looks like the horse got a little green, a little backed off early on. A little surprised, you know, all of that takes time, you know, and experience to get these horses to know the different things. I mean, it's a different course every time, as we know, you know, and different elements come at different places in the course. So I know that, you know, she and my husband will go assess what went wrong and make a new plan.
Kathleen Driscoll now is a lady with a plan as well for the Plain Bay Farm with Katie and Henri Prudon there. Katie, who was, both of them were top riders and now trainers as well. Rome, she had an amazing season last year, was the leading rider through the international shows up in Michigan at the lovely Traverse City venue there as well. She's come out strong this year as well. She's been winning in the five stars too. Wonderful, determined rider, has worked her way up. Actually came into Katie's, it was supposed to be a grooming position to start with, and now is their leading rider.
Yeah, she's a very competitive rider. She's had a great circuit, as you've said. You could see she really dug in there at the triple. I think that triple is riding very scopey, even more than the riders imagined when we walked the course. You know, even an experienced horse is needing a lot of support to get over that middle oxer. This horse also looks a little difficult in the mouth. It seems like, you know, as a rider, it's much easier to ride a horse that isn't difficult in the mouth, because obviously when the distances are so technical like that, the horse is fighting you, it's not concentrated on the fences, it's a distraction.
course, she just takes that fence with them as well. Clears the last okay. Going to be a score of 12.82.46 for Catherine Driscoll and a Rome. As I say, this is her first year really shifting up to this level.
Yeah, I mean, it was a solid round. She had just forward faults once again. So this is, you know, the time when she'll go back and she'll talk to Katie and they'll analyze what they can do better. Maybe they'll change the bid. The horse was fighting her a little bit in the mouth, so maybe they'll change the bid, or maybe they'll say, hey, next time you have to come in a little bit slower to the combination or something. But this is that's what we do, you know. After these rounds, we go and watch the video, assess what we did well, assess what we did wrong, try to improve. You know, it's an ongoing, endless game.
Absolutely. Bull Run's Gyra, and on to Kristen van der Veen for the Bull Run Jumpers with the 10-year-old for Kristen. Prolific winner here in the United States as well. Again, class after class. She's again building a new string of horses for her. She went so fabulously with Faustina Tilly right the way through to the World Cup finals. And now, as I say, building up the new sets for the next generation with Gyra. And as I said, she's a determined rider. She's a winning rider, Meredith. I'm interested to see what comes out today.
Yeah, me too. I mean, she's a very competitive rider. She's won a lot of classes, and I don't know this horse that well. Oh, she had to really look like she had to dig in there at the wall. I don't know if the horse is a little bit spooky, maybe a little bit inexperienced, and then just got had the top brick there off at the wall. It's maybe the first of that, actually. Somebody else rubbed it, but they seem to be jumping it pretty well.
Steps over the water all right, but just on the four already. And actually, that fence has ridden quite well because it's a natural colour in there. It's a little bit harking back to an old style fence, isn't it?
Yeah, you know, we had that fence the other day in another class, and they do jump it well with the natural rails over the Liverpool. I thought it would be more of a problem even the other day when we had it, but it seems like the colour... You know, that's very interesting. Some colors ride more difficult than others. And, you know, you never know. You're not looking through the eyes of the horse. So sometimes it's hard for horses to judge the depth perception of a specific color.
Coming home on the 12 faults for Kristen van der Veen and Bull Run's Gyra. Same new experiences for them this season. Finish on a score of 12 and just 84.55 as a time. Having a look there at the wall, unfortunately flicks that one off early on, Meredith.
Yeah, that was unfortunate, you know. But as we were saying, I think this horse is relatively inexperienced at this level. So it looked like a solid enough round, and she got some experience, and she and that horse will learn from it and make adjustments and try to fine-tune a lot of what happened tonight.
25-year-old Natalie Dean of the USA, and Natalie from California, the Marigold Sport Horses Cota M by Toulon. She's finished in the top placings of the Grand Prix so far this season. In fact, into fourth place back in the Grand Prix here last year. She's been top six this season as well. And alongside us too is Jimmy Tirano, who's been round this track. Jimmy joining myself and Meredith Michaels-Birbaum. Jimmy, let's talk Natalie Dean's round and what you felt riding it.
You know, this is a top horse, as Meredith said. Jumped a lot of clear rounds, represented the team at Aachen last year. It's probably the smallest horse in the class, but it's got a tremendous stride for its size. I think the course is tough. It's what we all expected tonight. I think everything is maximum height, maximum width. It's delicate. It's big. I think the time is probably just right. I think he did a very, very good job. He's going to, you know, he's already seen a few clear rounds. As you said, this Oxer right here, they're jumping it quite well. I thought with the Liverpool down, the lighting being a little strange there in those natural poles, it would come down a lot. But so far, they're jumping it quite well. Some have done seven. Some have done eight. You know, for me, my horse got a little bit weird going to the wall, not the wall itself. I think it was the Liverpool at that one Oxer, and put me on the outside track there. And, I was stuck on seven to the triple, and I had B down. But I got to say, I was quite happy with my horse. He jumped it very well, a good round.
And Natalie Dean is putting a real round together here.
Yeah, this looks excellent. I must say, oh, that was really unfortunate. What a light rail. What a shame. What a great ride. And as I was saying, is one of my favorite horses in the class. This would have been one, for instance, I would have liked to have ridden.
Yep.
Whereas I was saying, Jimmy, I'm sorry, but I don't think I could ride your horse. I wouldn't have fit too well on your horse. But that was a shame for Natalie. She rode great, and what a good combination this is. I'm really excited to see what they're going to do this summer. They're definitely coming into contention for all the teams coming up and maybe even the Olympics. And you know, we'll see what she can do.
She's going to be heading over to Europe base with Ben Mayer there as well as her trainer. Tokyo Olympics is Olympic silver medalist from Tokyo. Olympic gold medalist from Beijing is Laura Crouch, and Bisquetta Biscuit, as the horse is known, for the Cherry Knoll Farm, a long-time supporting sponsor of them. And this, again, a 10-year-old horse, and a little bit earlier on today, BC Madden was talking to us about that. You know, she's a horse with less experience, but Laura's got all the ability there to guide this horse around. Jumped well in the Nations Cup a few weeks ago. Jimmy, you've been watching this horse pretty closely.
Yeah, for sure. It's not her most experienced horse, but Laura has so much experience. She's jumped so many big championships. This is obviously a horse for the future. It was on the Nations Cup team last week in Ocala. And I think Laura will have to hold his hand a little bit tonight. Probably the biggest track it's jumped so far.
Yeah, she did well last week in Ocala. She had some great rounds there. But like Jimmy said, you know, these horses, they've got to go everywhere. They've got to go to different places. They got to see different jumps, different courses, different footings before they're really ready, so to speak.
She's keeping quite a bit of pace on this so far as well.
She opts for the 8 strides of the Oxer. Got a little stretchy maybe, but you know, this horse is a real, real trier. And again, Laura, with all the experience, the 4 got very, very steady. For me, I thought walking the course, this was the toughest part of the course right here. That double is, you've got to be very patient. It's boxy inside, wide Oxer coming out. But, you know, again, they seem to be jumping it pretty well.
Looks like an outstanding round. You can see Laura's giving the horse all the support, like Jimmy was saying. A greener horse. Oh, she jumped out beautifully. One left here. Come on, Laura.
Go on, Laura. Gets it done. And so the American experience rider goes through with the fourth clear, and Olympic medalist brings all that experience there. Meredith, that was class act.
That was exciting. You know, I mean, she's going to be so excited about that round with this new green horse. You know, it's going to be the backup horse to her other Olympic mount.
Yeah, Balotinu.
Yeah, all of a sudden now she's got two. So that's really exciting for her. I love watching Laura ride because she's such a fighter. You know, you can see she gives everything. The mare stuck off the ground a little bit at that Oxer we're looking at right now with the Liverpool under it. But you can see Laura never doubts. Yeah.
There's the owner down there as well. Yeah, looking very excited indeed. Yeah, absolutely delighted with that.
I bet.
Those are the clears so far. We hit the halfway stage of this Rolex $500,000 Grand Prix. Daniel Blumen gave us the early clear. Kendra, Clarissa Brinkhoff, Ben Mayer, Laura Crouch is shaping up nicely so far. Margaret Dupre there just going off the distance, the owner of Bisquetta. And that's how it looks so far. Pretty widespread across the nations as well.
Yeah, I was noting the flags. I love that there are four different flags up there tonight.
So it's all building nicely. As I say, we're going to take the halfway stage of this Rolex Grand Prix tonight. Very exciting one. 4 out of our group so far. We've got the remaining 19, in fact, coming up. Margie Goldstein-Engel electing not to go tonight, is scratched in there. But we've got the best of those coming out of qualifying still to come. It means Petter Fredriksson, it means Daniel Coyle, it means Christian Kukuk, it means Shane Sweetnam, Kent Farrington, and of course McLean Ward in there as well. An exciting night of competition, packed house here at the Winter Equestrian Festival once again. And we're getting ready for what's going to be that second half to build us up. And we're going to come back to you with all of that in just a few moments' time as we take a little breather and get a few words from our supporting sponsors too. We're coming back to you after this break.
It is not a machine, though the precision of its mechanics can draw some admiration. Propelled by a unique movement, graced with a singular drive, it has a personality of its own. It was born from a special bond. Crafted over years with infinite patience and utmost care. Listening to every tick, going over every move again and again. To build a trust like no other. The kind of trust that allows you to push further, higher. Always. The kind of trust that can transcend any challenge.
Well, our thanks to Brain Juice, the number one natural daily brain supplement and proud partner and major sponsor of Wellington International. Throughout the season two, supporting is Adequan, the American Regent Animal Health maker of Adequan, proud to sponsor at the Winter Equestrian Festival. And for over 30 years, Adequan has been trusted by veterinarians, trainers and horse owners alike. NetJets 2 throughout the season. With NetJets, your private aviation journey is transformed from routine to remarkable. It's done by personalizing every detail of your travels from the point of where you feel like your flight is their only one. For over 70 years, Rolex has been a global contributor to equestrianism, demonstrating the enduring commitment to some of the oldest and most revered events within the sport. And join us after the break.
With NetJets, travel will always be personal. We do everything it takes to make every flight exceptional. Every single detail of your experience is personalized, just for you. As our standard is not just to meet our definition of perfection, it's to exceed yours.
Yeah?
I fell.
Okay, there's bandages in the cabinet.
I'm bleeding.
Grab two.
Sheba, what cats want?
Is your cat getting too cool? Give him Temptations treats.
Welcome back to the Rolex Grand Prix here from Wellington. Tension building, first half completed with four clears already for an exciting lineup of riders here tonight. And Danny's down in the warm-up catching up with those that have been a big part of this as part of this finale night. Very good evening to you, Danny.
Thanks, Stephen. All right, I'm here with Henrik von Eckermann, number one in the world. You had a very frustrating four faults, but tell us, how did your round feel out there?
No, the round felt great to the fault. My mare Khaleesi, it's the first time she does something like this, especially in the lights and such a big class. So in that way, I'm really satisfied with her, but of course, makes my stomach sick of the four faults. but that's the sport. I would wish for a clear round, but not today.
And a huge atmosphere here tonight. Do you think that that plays a role as far as the horses jumping and how everything goes?
Yeah, but like I said, my one is quite sensitive, but she felt really great inside. And in the end, also my fault was maybe I pushed a little bit too much for the oxer coming in. I was a bit worried about the second pole because I felt that she was getting a little tired, and maybe I was squeezing a little bit too much and didn't sit up enough, and had the front fault with the front legs coming out. So it's a pity, but
yeah, for sure, very frustrating. Atmosphere as far as jumping here in Florida, do you think that your horse is, I don't know. Tell me, what is excitement as far as being here in Florida? Do you think it's different than it is in Europe?
I mean, for sure, this crowd was fantastic now. I mean, it was full house, and it's always nice to ride in front of such a crowd. I've been here 3 years ago, so I saw it once before, so I know it's going to be good. I was happy to be here. Now it's time to go home and look forward to next.
All right, well, good luck the rest of the season.
Thank you very much.
All right, Stephen, back to you.
Thank you very much, Danny. Yes, the excitement, the dancing, it's all underway. If you get to sit on the sidelines, it's nice and easy for you. Not so easy for out there riding alongside me is Meredith Michaels-Bierbaum, who's one who's experienced the atmosphere here before now. Meredith, like they said, it's a little bit special down in the cauldron there.
Got that? Oh, there we go. You could see the disappointment from Henrik. You know, he's a real player. You know, that guy is used to winning. He's used to going clear, and you could see, you know, that four faults is killing him. But like he said, here we go. This is a triple. His mare jumps so well. I mean, I love that about Henrik. He's an athlete. He's a sportsman. He wants to win. You know, and even though it was just an unfortunate fault, we're going to see it here. She had the momentum going in, and it just got so short for her. He said he maybe squeezed her too much, but I just thought it was interesting. He didn't try to sugarcoat it and say it was great and he's happy anyway. He actually
said, I'm disappointed. That's it.
And that was the truth. And that's how, you know, the great ones come back from that.
Absolutely. The great ones are out there. Laura Crouch is one of those, and she is down with Danny.
Thanks, Stephen. All right, Laura, congratulations. So exciting. How do you feel?
Oh, I feel amazing. I'm so proud of her. This was by far the biggest course she's ever had to tackle, and she just was fantastic from start to finish.
You seem kind of nervous walking the course. You were especially nervous about the triple line. How did that work out?
It worked out beautifully. I mean, she was just right on it, and she actually did it very easily. She's never jumped a double of oxers like that. And she just was on it.
Amazing. What do you think strategy for the jump off? It looks like it's going to be a fast one.
Yeah, it's definitely going to be a fast one. You know, she's quick. I'm going to go as fast as I can go. Again, she's sort of new to this level, so I'll do what I can do. And I'm very happy to have the clear round tonight. A double clear would be really good.
Absolutely. How many think we're going to see in the jump off? Another half to go.
I think there's going to be probably between 8 and 10.
Me too.
Ones to come.
Well, good luck, and we're rooting for you.
Thank you.
Back to you, Stephen.
Thank you, Danny. Yes, we certainly are, and the home crowd's going to be out for her in a big way here tonight, and all part of this Rolex $500,000 Grand Prix. Who's going to speed to the top? We will see, because this is a little like Formula One, because it goes in reverse order. Pole position is Christian Kukuk, who will go last. He jumped best in the qualifier of those that completed. Conor Swale actually won the class, but Christian Kukuk comes in as the best finisher from there. And so he gets pole on the grid. Meredith, what did we make of Laura Crouch and what she did today?
Well, I think she's just delighted. You could see that on her face, you know. And she should be. I mean, that mare jumped beautifully tonight. And that's what she's been, you know, bringing her along to do. I mean, she's been week in and week out giving the horse experience. And now it really paid off tonight. I mean, that was a beautiful round. I'm a great admirer of Laura's. She always comes up with a new horse. She has a great partnership with her horses. It was an outstanding to watch. She's an inspiration.
She certainly is. So Welcome back. It is a big night here in Wellington, and those are the clears so far. Daniel Blumen of Israel, Kendra Calusia Brinkop of Germany, Ben Mayer of Great Britain, Laura Crouch of the USA, four top-class riders in the mix already, and the second half to come of this Rolex five-star Grand Prix here tonight. And like I say, we go in reverse order of qualifying from earlier on the week. So as Laura Crouch has been saying, we could get more coming out of this. You, Meredith, have been saying the same thing, because this is a really strong second half as well.
Yeah, I think that sounded pretty accurate what Laura was estimating. I think there will be 8 to 10, at least four more in the second half. But as we said, it's even the stronger group because they qualified better. So maybe we could see even a couple more, but I doubt it. I think we'll be around like what Laura said, somewhere around 10.
Well, very strong group coming up includes the former winner, Richard Vogel of Germany. Sapano Balabay defends the title. He goes in our first couple back from the break. We've got Derek Kenny, five-star winner already this season. Kent Farrington, the world number five. Former winner here too, Ashley Bond. McLean Ward, the world number 10 with a new ride in Ilex. Harry Charles of Great Britain, the Rolex testimony, who's goes the world number 13, goes late in the order, goes 35th. And then on from there, it is Daniel Coyle, Andrew Bournes, and Christian Kukuk in the final few here. So plenty to contend with there. They've all got the credentials to do it. Some, like McLean, on a newer horse, but a horse that's been there and jumped into Nations Cup with a former rider, Fabio Leivas da Costa as well. Meredith, what do you think?
Well, I think it'll be interesting to see this second half go now, because these riders have seen all the problems. They've seen their colleagues struggle with certain elements, distances, and they can make a really good plan. They know what the time allowed is requiring. So, you know, obviously it's an advantage to watch the others, and we'll see. We'll see how well that goes over for them, whether they can really, polish off the places they need to and get that clear round.
So we're going into our second half tonight under the lights here for this Rolex five-star Grand Prix. And just down there is Peter DeVos waiting over in the warm-up under the spotlights there as well, just out of sight, just out of sound at the moment as well. Interesting to see it's packed down there as people are watching the top riders warm up. And actually, we've said in many weeks here as well, if you're an aspiring rider too, go and watch down there too.
Yeah, that's really interesting. I mean, to get a feel for what the riders are doing, you know, before they walk in the ring, how they're preparing their horses, what kind of warm-up jumps they're taking, how they're discussing it with their trainer or their groom, you know, how much time they're giving the horse to exhale, walk, relax, you know, how much they're pumping them up. You know, each horse is different. Each horse has a different plan. He's giving his horse a nice little pat there, a stroke on the ear. Some encouragement. So interesting. Each rider has his own sort of pre-game routine.
Welcome back to the second half of this Rolex Grand Prix. And to take us into our second half is a rider who's won all around the world, Peter DeVos of Belgium. First time here in Wellington, DeVos Show Stables, Tupi de la Roque. A hugely experienced horse now, 17 years of age, by Canon, this French bred ride with Peter that won the World Cup qualifier in Basel in Switzerland earlier on this year as well. So they're still very much in top form. He's a past winner of the Spruce Meadows Rolex Grand Prix there. He's won in Shanghai. He's a European medalist, European team gold medalist in 2019 as well. He's a super addition here, Meredith.
Yeah, I mean, Peter has been a really important part of the Belgium team. He's been a big player for his team, like you mentioned, with those medals for the team. And I don't know this horse that well, but as I was walking in, you can see, interestingly enough, he has no boots on the horse in front. Protective boots, and sometimes you know, that's unusual to see, but perhaps the horse doesn't like going in boots, perhaps it gets a little rub from the boots, but you can see he has nice white socks in front, and Peter's opted to keep his legs clean.
Nicely over the wall so far. Meredith Michaels, Bierbaum alongside me. Meredith, we go into the Rolex combination pretty early on. Remind us a few of the tests on this course as we go around with Peter.
Yeah, well, that was a scope test, that combination with the double oxer, but Peter's horse jumped it very easily without any problem at all. And he had a good, strong ride over the water, got the horse back nicely for the plank. And here we have a little bit of a tricky square oxer over the Liverpool. It also handled that very nicely. Here the triple bar, and then a very short four strides. Careful, Rico. Just drug his hind end a little. Little bit like Rodrigo Pessoa's horse there again. Looked like the horse lost his shape at the jump, we would say. You know, didn't follow through with the hind end. Sort of resisting the bridle, got a little hollowed out, we would say, as a rider. Didn't finish the jump behind on those in that those two places.
Coming home on the eight fulls reminder, time allowed of 85 seconds, so they're okay for that, but unfortunately that is not the key part here. Eight fulls is 82.03 for Peter DeVos and Tupi de la Roque, and there came the first fault there, Meredith's fault, but again, this double, as they just come around that corner, is catching them in the vertical.
Yeah, it's a sort of a 90 degree turn there after the line from the triple bar, and then it's right up against the open water, and I find that to be the trickiest part of the course and unusual. You know, we don't usually see a line like that. The course designer definitely put some thought into that line, and it's posing a problem.
Defending champion of the Rolex Grand Prix here, Sapanu Balabe and Richard Vogel of Germany, with the Coleridge Equestrians. Now 10-year-old by Shaman, won last year as a 9-year-old, jumped in his first 5-star Grand Prix there, got off to a flying start with a win. He since then won the 5-star Grand Prix in Monterey into November of last year. Richard Vogel has been an absolute flying. He won one of the Rolex majors in Geneva with United Touch going back into December as well. He really is one of the men of the moment. He's the current world number 9.
Yeah, Richie is just amazing. I mean, he's the highest ranked German rider at the moment. I always hope Richie gets in the jump off because I can't wait to see him ride fast. He's just so slick. He can ride even a slow horse fast. This is a fast horse, so if he does get in the jump off with this one, it's always so exciting. We saw that last year here in the Rolex Grand Prix, and he had a great win, as you mentioned. But Richie's been on fire. He's just been amazing. And I hope this little horse can produce a clear round. You can see how quick and fast his stride is.
And very different to last year, where there was no real expectation. And then
yeah,
suddenly you've got all
true.
The expectation.
I think Richie always has the high expectation. Wow, that was a light rail. You could see he just towed it. I mean, really, that was the clip of the hoof. It just caught it on the way down. What a shame.
On the four for Richard Vogel, then that's still very much in the money at the moment if they get home with a quick four faults, and 4.78 at 97. So actually he is the quickest of the four faulters, goes into fifth place so far with our four clears at the moment, moves Henrik von Eckermann down a slot. Another look here, Meredith.
He barely touches it. He shifts a little. I mean, that was just so unlucky. The horse jumped a brilliant round.
Well, yeehaw.
Oh, here, this is always fun to watch, too.
Carl Cook of the United States of America, and the incoming, making an entrance, Kalinka, the horse that he rode to win the $1 million Grand Prix in the Coachella Cup in the desert in California last year as well. He won the American Gold Cup last year too. A fiery pair together, but they do get results, and he won yesterday with Caracol as well, with a fast, fiery round in the speed class. And yeah, don't be deceived. They could get this done here.
Yeah, she's a wonderful mare, and Carl's had great success with her. Oh, he's a little lucky on that wall there. He rubbed it, but it didn't come down. Maybe woke her up a little for the triple. Wow, you saw how easily she just jumped B and C of that triple, like she had springs on her feet. I mean, she's just a wonderful horse, and he does a great job handling her. He kind of lets her keep her personality. You could see when she came in the ring and was bucking, and I think he thinks it's kind of funny. I think he thinks it's part of her that he lets her be. He doesn't try to dominate or discipline her. He just lets her show off, and it works. Beautiful. She just jumped that so easily. It's like a little deer, so light on her feet, so much ability. He had that third place a couple of weeks ago here in the five-star, I think, WEF9.
Yep.
He was first to go in the jump oven. I think he just rode a little casually because normally he's fast as lightning.
I don't think that's going to be a problem tonight if they can get there. Just the final Rolex socks. I just got to get across 1.75 meters, nose down, 81.84, and can't be discounted. Carl Cook with Sydney Ospreys Kalinka. What a mare, what a rider. It's excitement. That's what makes it fun.
Well, I'll be interested to watch him in the jump off because, like I was saying, I think he was a little asleep the other night, and I don't expect that to be the problem tonight. I would hope to see an aggressive, fast round from him tonight because the mare is so fast. She's so quick on her feet. She turns great.
There's
that
Eric.
Was a great ride.
There's Eric Navet down there, the man who's a past world champion for France, who trains with him. He trains him, and they are a fantastic partnership. Bliss Hears now of the United States, and a newer ride for Bliss, Quality Star Z, moving up into the five stars. So we've seen her with so many good results with Antidote de Mars. In fact, she won a five-star Grand Prix down in Mexico as well at San Miguel de Allende. Bridgeside Farms of Las Vegas. This is a former ride of Jérôme Guéry of Belgium as well. Had success with this horse, and now with this 11-year-old in the hands of Bliss, again as she builds a new partnership together, only been together since January, and this is their first five-star to kick things off. But, I mean, I've seen them a few times over the last week or so. Really nice-looking combination. This is their biggest test, without a doubt, but it'll be interesting to see how they get on.
Yeah, as you mentioned, Bliss had a tremendous success on her little stallion, and this one is new, but he jumped great in the qualifier. I think she just had time faults the other day. But like you said, it's a lot of course for a new combination. And you can see this one has also a little bit of character with the bucking in between. Looked slightly unconcentrated down that first line. Caught off guard with the width at number two. Here, the buck does not help as you're riding to the triple combination. But the horse has tremendous scope. You could see she didn't even have to put leg in the middle of the triple. But boy, I had a bucker once called Just Do It.
Yes.
And, you know, I didn't get too distracted by it. And Bliss doesn't seem to be either.
No. And that's the thing. As I say, they've looked so impressive in the last few weeks. I'm really looking forward to seeing this pair during the rest of the year as well. Again, plain covered poles over the Liverpool. Jimmy Tirano was talking about that a little bit earlier on. They've handled that well. Guy really using the colours the same way as he did our course designer from the Rio Olympics. He used them very effectively there. He's talked to us about that this week. Thought they were going to get there.
You know, she started to fight a little bit with her hand around that turn to the triple bar, and she had one stride too many there. She was too deep, so the mare couldn't get the width because it's an extremely scopy, or is it a gelding? It's a gelding, I didn't know. Extremely scopy horse, all the jump in the world. And here you could see just this pair needs to figure each other out a little more in the future, but I think from jumping talent, the horse,
yes,
you know, has got it all.
Yeah, absolutely. It's going to be a very exciting one to watch in the future. As I say, big step up for them today. A little bit of a buck and a play, but already you see that they're just starting to work each other out.
That'll be interesting. You know, I'll be interested to see in the weeks coming whether Bliss decides that she's got to discipline that buck. She's got to get a little bit more respect from the horse because it's distracting. You know, it can ruin a distance in a heartbeat as you're going to a jump if a horse bucks on the way, and it changes the striding and it changes the distance. So I'll be interested to see how in the next weeks she kind of goes along with the horse and tries to figure out how to get the horse to be a little bit more concentrated in the course.
Katie Diner now of the USA and Out of the Blue SCF. A newer one for her as well for the Grant Road Partners of New York was a ride for Shane Sweetman previously. She went brilliantly last year. She won the President's Cup at Washington. She's a past winner of the National Horse Show Grand Prix. She's been a team rider. She's been fantastic in the American Gold Cup before now. Won two Grand Prix last summer up in Traverse City in Michigan as well. But this has been a really exciting looking pair together very, very swiftly, Meredith.
Yeah, this horse looks like it suits Katie I must say the horse seems to give it all for Katie. They seem to be a nice new partnership, good partnership together. As you mentioned, you know, Katie had a success on her other horse, Brago. But this is exciting that she's already in the five-star with this one. She looked a little, I'd have to see another angle, slightly far off that triple bar. And just had it with the front legs with the back rail. And there she needed to support a little bit more going out. But these are all the little things that you don't know until you've done it. You know, you've got to go in there and figure it out.
Coming home on the eight foot so far. As you say, you've just got to get in there, work on it, see how it goes. They produced some lovely rounds so far this season. Just going to be on, fortunately, on the 8 today. Going to be inside the time at 83.42. And so 8 there for Katie Dunn and out of the blue SCF. But I'm excited to see them develop.
Yeah, it looks, like I said, a good partnership. I mean, this was a big track for these two tonight. They handled it in general very, very well. And Katie will, you know, like I said, rack up the knowledge, assess what went on with her trainer, Bear Manley. And I think you will see interesting things coming from those two in the future.
Shane Sweetnam of Ireland, and certainly one of the top horses in the world right now for the world number 11. This is James Cancruz for the Gizmo Partners, also known as Gizmo. And James Cancruz, Irish bred and now 11 years of age, an absolute superstar, has already been a winner of the American Gold Cup. They were team silver last year at the European Championships. They were top three in the Lugano Grand Prix earlier on this season as well. They won the National Horse Show Grand Prix World Cup qualifier last year too. They've gone to success after success, but he's so consistent, haven't they?
Yeah, I mean, since Shane got this horse, he's been amazingly consistent. He's had so many podium finishes with this horse. I mean, it's an incredible talent of a horse. It's fun to watch this horse jump. It's like he's almost like a rubber ball coming off the ground. Good combination, the two. The horse has tons of scope and ability.
Would this be a Meredith Michaels beer dam horse?
Yeah, people would say maybe it was a little big for me, but I think I'd feel very safe. Yeah, I would like him. He has so much blood and great attitude. You can see the expression of the horse. He likes his job. You know, you can really tell. The ears are forward. He's looking for that next jump. And you talked about
easily.
Consistency. You know, he's been around the world now, and it doesn't matter indoors, outdoors, grass, sand.
Now, not many have had that.
That was really a shame. I'll have to see that in replay. I don't know if he just was a little far off there again. Didn't ride quite enough across that triple bar, and the same with that Oxer coming out. You know, you kill yourself with a horse like this if there are mistakes, because you just feel responsible as a rider. You feel like you have such a talent under your saddle,
yeah,
and it's your job to bring him home.
Well, that's a shame, finishing on the eight fulls there, 83.45 for Shane Sweetnam and James Cancruz. In fact, we're going to whiz down to the warm-up area to Danny, who is down with our defending champion, but not to be for him today with Richie, Danny.
Thanks, Stephen. All right, Richie, defending champ, but not to be tonight. What do you think happened to the double?
I think, first of all, Zeppi, how we call him, jumped a fabulous round. I was super, super happy with him. I plan to really get him back in front of that, because he doesn't like vertical with the Liverpool underneath, so that's already not the ideal double for him. We managed the vertical, and then I was actually a little bit relieved and forgot about the Oxer rail, so I let him down a bit. I could have supported him a little bit better coming out of the double. So that's on me, but for the rest, I'm very happy and proud of my horse.
Right, well done. Thanks, Richie.
Thank you very much.
Back to you, Stephen.
Well, shame for Rich there, doesn't quite come off, but as we go to Derek Kenny now of Ireland, VDL Cartello, his Olympic ride in Tokyo. He actually won the five-star Grand Prix, the Fidelity Investments Grand Prix, in the start of the season with a horse called Amsterdam. Darren, absolutely top-class rider who's been based in the United States for quite some time now. And a pair together that have jumped lightly so far through last season, and really back into the groove of things now, Meredith. Not to be for Richie, but Dara can still fly the flag for the Irish here yet. Might be one for him.
Yeah, you know, this pair has tremendous experience together. Like you mentioned, this is his, was his Olympic mount. So they know the game. They've got a plan. He's walking in there with a plan. He's going to try to stick to it. He's seen his colleagues. He's seen all the problems this course has presented. Very good ride there. Dara's just an excellent rider. You know, he's a very, very smooth rider. He can ride any kind of horse. You could see there, he's coming a little deep to that vertical, and he just let the horse get off to one side a little, just to give him a little bit more room. You know, those are the clever things you can't tell somebody when you're trying to teach them. You just have to feel it, and you're great like Dara. That was excellent.
He certainly felt it. Felt a good round underneath them. Give us the sixth of the clears so far, Dara Kenny with VDL Cartello. So nicely done from Dara. His chance for a second five-star Grand Prix with the season. Or it could go to Carl Cook, who is now with Danny.
All right, Carl, congratulations. Fabulous. What's the strategy going into the jump off?
Well, it's the last week, it's the last class. You got to lay it out there. You got to know that you gave it a shot, because it's depressing if you don't feel like you really gave it.
Absolutely. All right, well, good luck out there.
Thank you so much.
Back to you, Stephen.
Rest assured, he will be laying it down. He's not going to be holding back from that point of view. Meredith Michaels-Bierbaum alongside me talking us through tonight as we go to Caitlin Campbell of the USA and the 3P Equine Partners Castlefield Cornelius. And Caitlin, who's been competing over on the West Coast, she was born over here on the East Coast, but over on the West Coast these days mainly, been out there all winter and gone very well there indeed. Then headed to Ocala last week, was top six in the big Grand Prix qualify there as well. With Castlefield Cornelius, again, the biggest test for this pair, but from what we've seen so far this week and watching in the qualifier, because of course we're going in reverse order, they finish well in that. This is a very nice looking horse. This might be a big step tonight, but a nice looking horse.
Yeah, you know, this horse came from Paul Schockemiller, was ridden in Germany by a very good German rider, Philipp Ruping. I think he even won the World Cup in Prague. Oh, that was a shame. That was rare. We haven't seen the C part of the triple combination come down much. She supported the horse at B and then just had too much momentum. The horse didn't really come back enough for C. And then here again, a little bit too forward at the plank. You can see this partnership is a little green together. They're just missing a little bit of finesse for this course. There, he made a great effort. So, I mean, as we've been discussing, you know, you've got to go in there, get the experience. The horse actually looks like a really, really good jumper.
They've looked impressive. I mean, I know the score's not saying that, just with the eight there, but they've still looked impressive. Like I say, this is their biggest test yet.
Yeah, she's doing a nice job. Good ride there. And finishes up really well, you know. I think she'll be happy with that round. I mean, I'm sure that's the biggest track they've had so far. And, you know, she has great expectations for this horse, I think. And, there he just stayed a little flat coming out. And the same there, he got his hind end was a little low, and you can see she lost the mouth a little, but managed to get him over that oxer.
Those the Grand Prix qualifiers so far into that jump off. Daniel Blumen at this stage, Kendrick Lucia Brinkhoff, Ben Mayer of Great Britain, the world number two, Laura Crouch, the Olympic gold medalist, Carl Cook, the winner of the American Gold Cup, Dara Kenny, five-star Grand Prix winner already this season as well, and Irish Olympian as our six so far. We go to an American Olympian, Olympic silver in Rio. He was then last year with this horse onto the team to win gold at the Pan American Games as well. The current world number five with the Super Landon, owned by Hetty McNerney, by Comilfo Plus, and Kent, well, he's never one to give away a class. He'll be in here fighting, and Landon has just looked so impressive. The horse he also rode to an individual silver at the Pan American Games last year as well. Looking forward to seeing these, Meredith.
Yeah, you know, Kent's a superstar, and he's brought along so many horses. He's won so many things, you know, all of the Rolex Grand Prix, you know, from Aachen, top 10 finals. I mean, he's just done it all.
Yeah.
Also a Rolex ambassador, so We'll be keeping our fingers crossed for him tonight in front of the Rolex crowd.
And this is a super horse that he's been building up this string together. I mean, just looks elastic and bouncy and ready to go.
Yeah, you know what I love about Kent?
Oh.
It was really a shame. Just couldn't get him back enough for that Oxer. The horse sort of ran him through the front rail. He looked like he had to start aggressive. Kent, he had to ride him aggressive through the first half of the course, and there you could see he just lost the mouth a little, and the horse ran him a little bit too deep and had that front rail. That was a shame.
Well, that's going to be Kent Farrington, I'm afraid, out of the equation, but fighting for a fast four here to still get in good money here tonight, and he could well do that. And Kent Farrington and Landon home at four faults for them, 81.96, and puts him a little bit further down into 11th place so far. Fastest of the four faults being Richard Vogel of Germany and Sapano Balubay. What are your thoughts, Meredith?
Well, you could see there in the replay, he just had too much forward momentum. The horse never slowed down, and Ken could never get him to slow down to clear that front rail, you know. That's a little bit the test I was telling you earlier on, when you have to override the water, and then there's a jump with the water underneath it. The horse is naturally thinking forward, so it's a test to see if you can bring him back, get the height again, and not just the forward momentum. That was missing there for Ken tonight.
Ashley Bond now representing Israel with Donatello. Ashley, a past winner of this Rolex Grand Prix. It was out on the field then with Caroline of Bullmore, which we mentioned a little bit earlier on. Donatello, 11th individually at the Olympic Games in Tokyo last time around. Another fast combination. This would be an interesting one to go up against Carl Cook, but he's not going to because they've just had the middle of the Rolex combination.
Wow, that's come down a lot tonight. I love watching this combination. You know, these two, there's also a great partnership between them. And they're both fighters, Ashley and her little stallion. It's just always fun to watch them. He's a tiny horse. He's got a smaller stride. She ends up having to add a lot of strides, but she just does her own thing. She doesn't look around and wonder what the others are doing. She sticks to her own plan. She knows what's best for this horse. That was a shame in the triple. He really tried going out there. I'd be curious to look at how many times that B element of the triple combination came down, the back pole.
Ashley coming home again. Just could be on the four fault, still potentially in the money for them because it's going to be a fast four from that point of view. Ashley Bond and Donatello going on the four faults into eighth place at 80.11 for her turn back into the Rolex combination here, Meredith.
So let's see, jumped A, great. She fought over B and just didn't get the width. You know, it's riding longer and scopier from A to B than anyone is really anticipating.
Tough one, so Ashley Bond not through the 2-3 from this second half of the class so far with Carl Cook and Dara Kenny. McLean Ward now, the world number 10. And interesting combination here because it is McLean, the Bonchance Farms Ilex. Now, a newer pairing together, not to say that horse and rider haven't been and done it. Of course, McLean, double Olympic gold medalist himself, Olympic silver, all the long list of successes, won the Grand Prix here 2 weeks ago as well. And a horse that was formerly with Fabio Leves da Costa of Brazil, very successfully here and as part of Nations Cup. Now, this is their first real big test together, and this is another horse with great power and ability and even Olympic potential.
Yeah, you know, I think this is McLean's big hope for the Olympics. I mean, he knows the talent of the horse. You could see it right there over the wall. What a great jump the horse has, how much scope. Let's see here. Oh, he jumped that so beautifully. Oh, you got to know, McLean's just beaming inside right now as the horse cleared that triple combination so easily. Great jump over the water. And McLean's been in great form. You know, week 10 here, he had two wins on First Lady in the WEF and Contagious in the four-star Grand Prix. And that helps, you know, being confident, being, you know, feeling like you're in good form.
Well, he talked about the frustration that he hadn't got a Grand Prix win up to that point, because he always likes to get one off the bat and get going, and just been so close. He's been on the podiums, but he's got that, and this is looking really good.
Yeah, you know, the horse has a really good expression. You can see the horse is searching for the jumps. His ears are forward. He looks positive. In between, he loses a little bit of his style. His hind end seems to tuck under him once or twice, but then all of a sudden the horse almost remembers and then follows through behind.
This place is going to erupt. There it is. McLean Ward and Illex, 81.93 as a time. Fine for time. McLean Ward is certainly franking the ability of this pair and showing what they can do. I think there's definitely going to be a smile there.
I saw a smile and I think he even said, wow. I really do. I mean, that was a big round for McLean tonight.
Yeah, well, McLean Ward breaks into joy down there, and well, the rest of his team as well, kicking along too, nervously. Lee McKeever, I'm sure, his man on the ground, is going to be at the back there too, swinging legs in all directions, and he is going to be very, very happy with that.
Definitely.
There's Lee.
There's Lee, and that's a biggie boy, because he wants to take that horse to the Olympics, and that just... you know, made him feel so secure and good about it.
Kian O'Connor of Ireland, a man who knows all about Olympic credentials, having been a bronze medalist in London. He's been one of the best riders for the teams for Ireland over the years as well. And Kian with Maurice, combination that were also on the podium in the five-star Grand Prix this season. In fact, going back to the Fidelity Grand Prix, they finished in second place there. Really good combination. Once again, this former ride of Omar Karayevli of Turkey. And he's really built up such a strong string around him. And now is the night where he can really let this go.
Yeah, I mean, this horse jumped beautifully the other night with his second place finish. Again, Kian, like you said, has a great string of horses, of Olympic type horses. This is also one of his best. He told me, boy, did he stretch over that middle. You could see how the horse sort of turned himself inside out to get over B. That just shows you how scopey that combination rides. But what a trier the horse is, because he really did everything to clear it. That was a great
yes.
ride to that. Wow, he just sort of flicks out behind with his hind legs. He certainly knows where his legs are, this horse. He sort of does what it takes. He sort of changes his style accordingly so he doesn't touch a rail.
Irish in amazing form as well at the moment. They were 1-2-3 in the first Grand Prix of the season. And he's got a chance again. Whoops, sit tight. 83.19 is okay for time as well.
Wow.
Kian O'Connor gives us number 8 of the clears. Meredith, what did you make of that?
Yeah, I mean, that was expertly ridden. You could see Kian knew every minute where he was. The horse, like I said, he's interesting. He flicks out his hind end when he needs to. He twists a little bit if he has to. Sort of gives it all. It's maybe not super conventional at every fence. Like, even there, it's so funny. He has a temperament, the horse, but he's a fighter and positive, and he really wants to do it, you can tell.
Well, they're in there as one of 8 clears now as part of this Rolex Grand Prix tonight. René Dittmer now of Germany, the Live Oak Plantations, Burlington Riverland. Live Oak is where his partner Chloe Reed is based, the Reed family. There, so riding this horse for them. He's had such a wonderful run here in Wellington as well. He won a Grand Prix here back in December with a horse called Corsica, and now has come in on tremendous form through the year. He's been really consistent as well, and he's spent some time with you too.
Yeah, René. René was our rider for 3 years, and Marcus sort of discovered René down the road. He was riding young horses, and we hired him, and he brought along young horses in our stable. He was extremely successful at the national level. And after that, he's gone on his own. And this horse, for instance, was the horse that kind of made him the breakthrough to the international level. And as you mentioned, he has another mare, Corsica, he's had tremendous success with last fall. He's done really, really well.
Yeah, had a wonderful run here in the fall as well. He went to Washington, finished second in the World Cup qualifier, won two other classes, won classes across the board at those big indoor shows, and then won here in Wellington too.
Yeah, this looks really, really good.
Just cut down a little short.
You know, it was exactly the opposite of what, for instance, Ken Farrington had, where the horse ran through his hand, ran him a little bit deep and had the front rail. There you could see that Rene was trying to give the horse time and space off the ground, and then the width caught him. He just tapped the back rail. You know, but that's how precise and exact you have to be. I mean, it's just inches that make the difference.
Again, on the four, he might be a little bit steadier, so further down the list, but overall a good round, this final Rolex Oxer. And there he gets it done with the four faults for René Dittmer and Burlington Riverlands, going into 16th place on the first. Quite a few on the four faults now.
Yeah, I mean, that shows a great course and a good, brilliant course designer, because there were faults all around the ring today. Every jump had its own difficulty. It wasn't like everything was just about one combination or one fence. René had a solid round, you know. I think he'll be pleased with that too. That horse hasn't done that many classes at that level. But like you said, you can see how easy it was to have four faults tonight.
Harry Charles of Great Britain, the world number 13, also Rolex testimony for the young 24-year-old, already proved his worth on plenty of occasions already, and certainly franked his form with a wonderful list of horses today, riding for Ann Thompson with Arrow in Blue. But he really came out of the blue when he won the World Cup qualifier and the London Grand Prix on home ground a couple of seasons ago now, and he has the first fence.
Oh, what a disappointment. You know, again, on replay, we'd have to watch that. I just don't know if he was a little casual about it. The horse was definitely a little casual. He didn't jump it very well. You know, as a rider, you're thinking about so many things when you're going in. He's thinking about, you know, the distance down the first line. He's thinking about the approach to the wall. He's thinking about the hard triple combination and the water and the this. And sometimes you just, for a second, don't think about the first fence, you know?
That's the hard part I was going to ask you about, how you compartmentalize. I mean, and now putting a really nice round together, which is what really frustrates you.
Yeah.
But how do you keep all that knowledge, if you like, in your head and not get wrapped up in it, not get spaghetti going on up there?
Well, you know, I think the course walk is really important. And for instance, I'm always one who goes and looks at the first fence, and I see a lot of riders who are in a hurry or amateur riders, and they never look at the first fence. They go, oh, there's number one, and then over two, here's two, and then they walk the line down the line. And I think to myself, I don't go and look at the first fence, because I find the first fence can be very challenging, even though it's not that big, maybe. It's not set that high. You know,
it plays its, but they all count.
They all count.
They
good
all count.
Point.
And
good
it played a big part in the Fidelity Grand Prix earlier on this year.
I definitely think Harry Charles was paying attention at the first fence. I was not indicating that, but anyway, I was just saying, you know.
It catches you. Yeah. It catches the bet. Like I say, it happened earlier on this year. Petter Fredriksson now of Sweden, the world number 25 as he is now, and truly one of the great horsemen of the sport. Wonderful to have him here in Wellington this week as well. Olympic team gold, world championship gold, individual silver twice, back-to-back Olympic Games. A wonderful accomplishment, also a frustrating accomplishment with the great all-in. But he also walked away with team gold as well, and has been such a big part of the Swedish squad. Al Capone de Camille for the ride here tonight for Pedder. Horse that was produced back in the UK from James Davenport and Angelie von Essen. And has really looked, again, super. But just, again, getting more mileage now for this combination together. But it's a horse that's got plenty of years on them as well. 14 years of age now, ready to go, basically. They've come ready out and firing.
Yeah, this is looking good so far. Peter's just an amazing rider. And boy, has he been a backbone for the Swedish team. The success that that Swedish team has had in the last years is just incredible. And a lot of it... Oh, the triple bar goes again.
Now, it's not so often you'll see the triple bar go like, but again, he just got height, didn't get width.
Yeah. You know, it's away from the in-gate. It's a little bit on a funny angle. The riders don't want to override it because of the distance to the next vertical is very short in four strides. So maybe they underestimate it a little and don't give quite enough leg to get across that back rail.
Just going to finish on the four for Peter Fredriksson and Al Capone for the Swedish rider. Goes into 16th place on the four, like I say, a long list of four falters so far. Here we see at the triple.
That was unfortunate. It looks like the horse dove a little to the right-hand side. And, you know, that makes it just that much wider. But what a great rider over so many years Peter has been. His great horse All In was always so fun to watch. The consistency that he has in his own riding and his program and the team behind him, how strong they've been in supporting him.
Fellow Swedish rider Petronella Andersson now, and Petronella with Kaskos van der Bajanaka Z, and has again been a combination that have come out very strongly for the Swedish as well. They jumped at the European Championships last year. She was top eight in the five-star Grand Prix in Ocala last week as well. Jumped on the teams in Aachen last season just for four faults as well. She really has come into her own now.
Yeah, you know, Petronella has been an extremely hard worker at the Steffex Stables. She's brought along all these wonderful young horses, given them time, experience, and now she's coming up with all of them to the five-star level, so it's fun to watch.
That the waters of the plank has actually ridden pretty well, hasn't it?
Yeah, I must say, I think everyone thought at the course walk that that would pose a little bit more of a problem, but they, in general, jumped that plank pretty well. She's having a very good round, but this is this tricky double here. Oh, what a great job. You can see that the horse has an interesting style. It's sort of got a very round jump, but a little bit of an awkward jump. Looks a little bit hard to sit on. Ah, is that the first time that's come down?
Could well be. Yeah, I think it probably is. So it adding to the score, it's eight coming home for Petronella Andersson of Sweden. Kastres van der Bajanaka Z just going to finish on the eight faults there. So not to be for her. Eight is the number of clears to date. And Danny is down with one of the big favorites for the night, Danny.
Thanks, Stephen. McLean, congratulations. Great round. You've been knocking on the door with this horse. What pulled it all together tonight?
Well, I mean, we've only had him about 7 weeks, so it's been a quick learning curve. He was actually great in the Nations Cup, brilliant in the five-star Grand Prix. The last fence down last week, I went early and overrode the time allowed. Just putting the pieces together. The horse is an incredible talent.
And what strategy for the jump off?
We're going to win.
Excellent. Good strategy. Thanks, McLean. Back to you, Stephen.
Keeping it simple there, Meredith.
That's,
I'm gonna
win. Confidence. I love it.
But I
don't know if I would ever have said that, though.
But you can see it in his eyes. He's like, I've got this. I'm doing this.
Yes, yes.
Right, on now to Ireland and Daniel Coyle with an incredible start with his new horse for him. They jumped into the winning spot at the Live Oak World Cup just a couple of weeks ago, and that was pretty well one of their very early shows. So he's not holding back here, Daniel Coyle, again up in the world's top 20. Daniel, current at world number 14. Amazing season that he's had. He's won two World Cups in Leipzig and Amsterdam, but he's not going to win this tonight.
Yeah, there it comes again, you know. B element of the triple combination, back rail. I mean, I would like to know the numbers on that. That has definitely been the most often, railed down in this course. But Daniel Coyle, boy, he has had an amazing run. He's just won so much with his mare legacy, World Cups in Leipzig, Amsterdam. I mean, he was on the winning team. I believe in Ocala for the League of Nations. Just Live Oak with this one. I mean, he has really had a season.
Absolutely. And top 10 in Geneva in the Rolex Major there as well with Legacy. But coming home on the forehand, as I say, it's a very new combination. So I don't think he's going to be too displeased with this round overall. I mean, they came out with a win the other day, but to get that consistency pretty well off the starting blocks, just one down into 12th, is pretty good going.
Yeah, it was a light fault. You know, unfortunate here, we can see it a little closer. He rode in, he rode up, you know. It looks long, it rides long, that two strides. You could see how he looked over to the scoreboard, I think, to see if he really had it down or not. It seemed kind of obvious, but maybe he didn't know if it stayed in. Yeah, he would be happy with that. That horse has really stepped up to a whole new level.
Well, staying with the Irish and Andrew Bourne's now, and he's the second best in qualifying as it is now, because this is the penultimate combination to go in tonight's Rolex Grand Prix. The Bourne Sport Horses and QBS Equestrians at Sea Top Blue for, again, the Irishman based here in Wellington, Florida. They've been a Grand Prix winner here before now, the NetJets Grand Prix here in Wellington as well. Winning team ride also for the Irish, including in Vancouver last year too, and went on a European tour of shows as well as part of the Irish team. Really, again, solid pairing together, and it's a horse by Chaco Blue that's come out so well, now 13 years of age and absolutely prime and ready to go, Meredith.
Yeah, these two have been together for a long time, so he knows his horse. You know, it looked a little bit like he didn't come in quite straight enough to that triple, and then by not being straight, the distance was even longer from A to B. Yeah, that was, you know, a harder fault. The horse really didn't have a chance to get over B.
And again, works well through that line. That's been a tricky one, but this has been one of the hardest, and they accomplished that too. Gives it some space back to this.
You know, this course, there's like no breathing time in this course. It just, everything comes up so quickly. And each line and each jump seems to be a challenge. You know, there's just no room to exhale here tonight.
Finishing on a score of 12 for Andrew Bourne's and Sea Top Blue, and so we'll put them further down the order on the 12th horse there. Here we look back at the Rolex combination, Meredith.
Yeah, I don't think he got quite a good straight enough run at that. You know, I don't know if he should have done one more stride, gone out, you know, or he was too deep actually at the A element as well. The horse had to really back off, and the A element stopped him, stopped the forward momentum. And then he was way too far off of B, and unfortunately no chance to get over it.
There's the clear so far. Daniel Blumen, Kendra Calusia, Brinkop, Ben Mayer, Laura Crouch, Carl Cook, Derek Kenny, McLean Ward, Kian O'Connor. Just one left that can go on that list. We're at the eight that you and I discussed.
Yeah, that's right.
Beforehand, but there's a German rider left, and he's a very effective one. Christian Kukuk, world number 20. With Madeleine Winterschulz's Checker 47 by Comme Il Faut. We heard from Luke Gebirbaum a little bit earlier on, because Christian, based with Luke, has been right of him for quite some time now. And part of the winning team last year at Barcelona, Christian Kukuk, and the Nations Cup there, finished well for a team silver medal on home ground in Riesenbeck before now. And as Luke was saying earlier, this horse in a Grand Prix, absolutely top form at the moment.
Yeah, Christian has been an amazing addition to the Riesenbeck team for Luke Gebirbaum. He has been so successful in the Global Champions Tour, riding clear rounds, winning those Grand Prix. You know, I think they were the winning team in Prague and the overall winners of the series, and a lot due to Christian Kukuk.
Yeah.
So he has been a big player for Luke and his team.
And rode a different grey earlier on this week, Mumbai, to get, it actually was second place in the qualifier, but top in qualifying here for this class. And this is looking good so far. They've just got to keep their balance, the control around back here to the vertical, which they do nicely.
Yeah,
ooh, little play.
Our fingers crossed here down the last line here for Christian.
One left to go for Christian Kukuk and Checo. 47, it's going to stay.
He was lucky on the last. That's what it takes, though, I'm telling you. That was very lucky. We'll see that in slow motion, I hope, because it'll be interesting how he hit that and it didn't fall, because there are safety cups on those back rails.
Here we come down this line.
And usually that kind of a touch will bring the whole rail down and the cups. So let's see.
Oof.
Interesting.
Just rolled. Great. Just rolled. You got a little bit of luck played there, but you'll take it when it comes. So Christian will add to the clears. 9 of them in total for this Rolex Grand Prix here tonight. $500,000 class. That's the concluding 9 that will go into the jump off. Daniel Blumen will start things off for Israel with Ladriano Zed. Kendra Clarissia Brinkhoff of Germany. 2 in there for Germany. Christian Kukuk to close things out. The world number 2, Ben Mayer. Laura Crouch of the US. Carl Cook will certainly be fiery in there with Kalinka as he goes 5th in the order. Darragh Kenny, 5-star winner already this season for Ireland. McLean Ward looks confident, looks focused. The US rider goes 7th. Kian O'Connor, solid again. He's been on the podium already this year into these Grand Prix with Maurice, goes 8th. And finally, it is Christian Kukuk of Germany to complete. We're building up to what is the jump-off of this Rolex Grand Prix here tonight. Meredith Michaels-Bierbaum and myself will take you through that jump-off in a few moments' time, just as the track to head on in to make all things ready. Our thanks to Bainbridge again, proud sponsor here at the Winter Equestrian Festival once again, and to our presenting sponsors for the 5 stars, including Fidelity Investments as well, and our thanks to Rolex once again, their long association with equestrianism, championing performance or respecting traditions as well. Great tradition tonight here as part of the Winter Equestrian Festival. We'll be back in just a few moments after this break.
It is not a machine, though the precision of its mechanics can draw some admiration. Propelled by a unique movement, graced with a singular drive, it has a personality of its own. It was born from a special bond. Crafted over years with infinite patience and utmost care. Listening to every tick, going over every move again and again to build a trust like no other. The kind of trust that allows you to push further, higher. Always. The kind of trust that can transcend any challenge.
Pegasus is going down in a major way, the biggest.
Presented in part with the support of the US Equestrian Federation and the USEF Network. With NetJets, your private aviation journey is transformed from routine to remarkable. And it's done by personalizing every detail of your travels to the point where you feel like your flight is their only one. Our presenting sponsor tonight, Rolex, and Rolex's association with equestrianism is based on championing performance while respecting traditions. It's a long-term partnership that includes alliances with world-class athletes, events, and governing bodies. And it's one filled with stories of perpetual excellence. Stories of Rolex. Join us for more here from Wellington after the break.
Cleaning your dog's teeth can be hard. But not with Greenies Dental Treats. Greenies, make health a treat.
At Nutro, we believe in growing healthy dogs. Our nutritious food is made with high-quality, natural ingredients to help dogs live full and active lives. Let's grow healthy dogs.
Well, welcome back, and we're set to go into this Rolex Grand Prix here tonight, and Meredith Michaels Bierbaum alongside me to talk it through. Our thanks to Rolex once again, and as they support the Rolex Grand Slam, those four fabulous events around the world, and they take in everything from the Dutch Masters in the last few weeks through to, of course, Geneva and Aachen and the Great Spruce Meadows, as well as part of that circuit too. And we're going to be talking through what's happened so far into our rounds. We've got nine clears at this stage, Meredith, from that point of view. It's all done and dusted to that. Now we've got to sort out who's going to be the winner.
Well, I think it's a perfect number. It really compliments to the course designer. He did a brilliant job here tonight. We had a great field of riders and horses, and you could see that there were problems around the course. Not just one obstacle presented all the problems. The triple combination, that bending line there, and even the last line was tricky. So I enjoyed watching the class. We saw some of the best, and I think the jump-off is going to be extremely exciting.
Absolutely. Let's run through some of those that we're going to be seeing in there. Daniel Blumen, as we say, going to be starting us off. Kendra Clarissia Brinkop, a name that some might not know as much, but she was really stylish.
Yeah, she's a great rider. You know, she's a very competitive rider as well. Here we see Daniel. Yep. He had a great round early on. He made it look so easy. It was just brilliant. You know, you could see the long-term partnership come through.
Here's Kendra.
And Kendra, like I said, is just one of Germany's best female riders. So I'm excited to see her have a clear round and be in the game.
She looks pretty excited herself. Third of the clears coming from Ben Mayer of Great Britain.
And I love this mare. I mean, I'm a great admirer of Ben's as well. He just produces horses just again and again. But I think this is a real talent he's got.
Laura Kraut and Bisquetta also got dug in there.
Yeah, fun for her. A new horse at this level just makes her string so much stronger. And she'll give her all, as she always does.
Carl Cook and Kalinka will certainly be a disruptor tonight.
Yeah, you know, I think, as I told you, you rode a little slow the other night, was third out of three in the jump off, and I think tonight he's going to give it his all.
It certainly is. And from Carl Cook into success there, on to the likes of Dara Kenny. Now, again, looking for another five-star win this season, Meredith.
Yeah, he's had one already, and this is his Olympic horse from Tokyo. I think he'll have a good shot.
McLean Ward seems confident with a pretty new Ilex. He said 7 weeks we've been riding together.
Yeah, and he was so determined in that interview. I just can't wait to see what he can pull out of the hat.
And so leaving us with Kian O'Connor and Maurice also into that jump off. And then finally, Christian Kukuk of Germany for Checker 47 could well bring it home here today as well. Looking forward to how this plays out for this jump off. We're going to take a look at the course as well for what is upcoming for this Fidelity Investments course. And here is the animation as we take a walk around the track. And Meredith, this time we're kicking off at fence two to make things a little bit different to the black and silver.
Yeah, so start off at two and then a quick rollback. I don't know if that's still a wall out there.
Yes, it is.
Yeah. Yep, so it's a rollback right on the wall. And then up to the BC portion of the triple combination.
Yeah, what was the Rolex triple combination from there? And then new fence coming into play here is fence 15 this time with the horse's heads there. And this is a little tightened up oxer there. Only 130 wide is going to be very interesting.
So that's then skinny oxer, as they call it.
Fence one.
Back over again. Fence one. Across the middle to a new fence again, number 16.
Little bit of a slice going to come in there. That could favour Carl Cook from that point of view. He likes to go for those. And then finally, it is the Rolex Oxer to finish off. Plenty of ground to cover, Meredith.
Yeah, you know, you can see the rollbacks on number 2 and then 15. Like, how daring are you willing to be to roll back to those jumps? And then that serpentine across the middle, you know, their riders will try to be as direct as they can be. The straightest line is the fastest, and the least number of strides is definitely the fastest.
Now, there's no point in me having one of the best riders in the world without getting your opinion on who you think is going to win this.
Oh, boy. Hmm. You know, I think this class will not be over until we see Christian Kukuk last to go. That was the winner of the five-star in Riyadh. Christian with Checker. And I think it won't be over until he's through the timers.
Until he's done his thing. Yeah. Okay. Into the jump off we go, and it is going to be into our start off here with Daniel Blumen and L'Adriano Z this time around. And Big L set to go, like we said, was out there with BZ Mann as well, getting a good idea of all of this. It's a huge experience combination. They've won the Rolex Rome Grand Prix before now, Hampton Classic, and winners here in Wellington before now. He won this class back in 2012 with the horse called Sancha LS, and now he's got another shot here. Meredith, it's a big jumping horse, covers lots of ground, not always the quickest, but has the ability to do this.
Yeah, but you know, these two know each other just so well. It's an old married couple, and he can really do these turns. Watch this here. Look at this. How about that?
Yeah.
I mean, that's trust. That's pure trust between horse and rider. Now he's got to go as direct as he can. They've obviously walked a number of strides there. And the same thing again here to the last, the quickest, directest route to the last fence. Come on. Yeah. That was a great, great round. Put the pressure on the rest.
37.16 the time. And Daniel Blumen, L'Adriano Z, setting the standard for those into this Rolex Grand Prix tonight. And you just saw their ability, especially back to this oxer here. I mean, they just stepped over it.
Yeah, I mean, that was a fantastic turn. And the horse gave him everything. He never gave up. You know, the horse, as you mentioned, is not by nature as fast a horse as you know, a little thoroughbred type. Like
a Kalinka.
Kalinka. But that said, it has a huge stride. The two of them know each other. I mean, they didn't leave much room. That'll be interesting.
Very interesting. 37.16 then for Daniel Blumen to start us off with L'Adriano Z. Taking us to Kendra Claricia Brinkhoff and the Steffex Stables in time. Now, you said a little earlier, I mean, you're so impressed with her as a rider, Meredith.
Yeah, she's a very competitive rider, so she knows how to go fast. I mean, I'm not sure how fast she's done rounds with this horse. I would question a little bit the rideability, the mouth, but she knows how to ride fast, so let's see what she can do.
Yep, so it is Daniel Blumen setting the pace, 37.16.
So you saw her eyes over number one, look back at that wall.
Just got too tight, down comes a brick.
You know, Daniel's put the pressure on, they're gonna have to risk everything. This is so tricky because it's a rollback here. And if you just angle it too much, you're almost heading right towards the Rolex combination. So it's a tricky turn there that Daniel did so well.
It's nice here at the Weff fence now. Dan's last again with four faults. She still wants to keep the pace up here because there's some massive money on the line here and could well be up the order yet. 38-43 finishing on the four for Kendra Clarissa Brinkop and in time. Meredith, your thoughts here just at the wall.
Yeah, she got a little deep there. You know, she was trying to make the best turn possible, but I think it came back a little bit to what I was saying. It's, you know, the horse's mouth is not easy, and so she wasn't quite sure how well the horse would turn, and I think she pulled a little hard, and she ended up, actually, the mare started turning much better than she even thought, and she got there way quicker and way deeper than she anticipated.
World number two, Ben Mayer and Dallas Vegas Batty for Pamela Wright and Charlotte Roster, the American owners of Tilly. And now the twice Grand Prix winning rider already this season, the world number two, chance to get some big numbers here in this Rolex Grand Prix here tonight. He'll be slick, you know that.
Ah, that's a tough turn. You see he got stuck there at the wall, but she did a great effort to clear it. Let's see what he can do here. He gave himself a bit more room. You could see that he went out at least one or two strides more than Daniel. But it is a quicker going horse.
37-16 to beat. Ben Mayer down to the last. He's going to run close. He's going to run very close for them. Is it going to be enough? I'm not sure it is. No. 37-60 wow, into second for Ben and Tilly. Meredith.
You know, I think here you can see that this that turn, he really was deep and under the wall. You know, and he lost his momentum. Then he had to really push for this double. And I almost think after that, Ben said, okay, I got to settle down,
yep,
bring her home safely. It almost looked like he didn't want to push anymore. And I think that's where he lost those tenths of a second.
So going into second place there for Ben Mayer and Dallas Vegas Batty. Daniel Blumen still leading L'Adriano Z, 37-16.
So once again here, I'm wondering how this mare turns, because I know that turning with a hackamore in a bit is not the easiest thing to do. So if she's not a great turner, this will be a tough jump off for Laura.
Laura Crouch and
Biscay. She gave herself one more stride there. The mare slipped a little behind.
US Olympic medalist giving it everything so far. A little less experienced combination, as you say, at this tighter turn than Ben Mayer there.
Ooh.
Couldn't get across it.
You know, she just also slipped a little bit in the turn there. It looked like the ground didn't hold perfectly for her. The horse lost her footing already in the first turn. Then again to that skinny oxer. I think the jump off is hard to ride, you know.
Yeah.
There are some jump offs that are easier to ride, meaning that it's easier to keep the flow. But I think these rollback turns that are in this jump off make it very difficult to ride smoothly. You're sort of forced around the turns, forced to risk everything, and you can see there it didn't work out for her.
And it's that way you've just got to be a little bit cautious there, so you can't necessarily go as much as you'd want, so you've got to be clever.
That's why I almost think that Ben slowed it down,
yeah,
after his beginning, because he realized he was pushing the envelope, so to speak. And now you can see how great that round was from Daniel Blumen, with that horse that he knows like the back of his hand. You know, the two of them were not over-challenged, but now we're going to really know what the time was all about.
Carl Cook and Kalinka, winners of the American Gold Cup last year, the Coachella Cup in California as well. They're renowned for fast, they're renowned for exciting, into the Rolex double.
This is a super fast horse, just a fast going horse. It's always moving. He's given himself a little more room on those turns, so now he's got to speed it up. That was great. Very direct, one less stride there. Look at that. Wow. He's on it.
He's certainly on it, but is it going to be enough? It
might
be. Carl Cook goes for the line. 36-62. It is. It certainly is. Carl Cook into the lead with Kalinka once again. The Californian flying high.
I'm so happy to see him do that. I know he was disappointed the other day, but I'm so happy to see that. You know, and it's interesting, his tactic, he didn't force those turns in the beginning. He knew he was sitting on a fast mare. He didn't force those two rollbacks that are very difficult. But then he let her rip, you know.
Yes.
Then he put the pedal to the metal in that last line. He made that serpentine as straight as he could, went directly from fence to fence, had one less stride. So now we're going to see how that holds up. Because I do think he now puts the pressure on the others to force those turns in the beginning.
Dara Kenny of Ireland, the world number 16, Grand Prix winner earlier on this season on his Olympic ride, VDL Cartello for the Heathman Farm. Like you say, he's really put the screws in now, saying, come on, you're going to work really hard to get that. And Dara's not going to get it with that fence down.
No, that was a shame. He was thinking about the turn to the wall. There you could see it. He had a little angle on number one. His eyes were looking really early. He was doing all the right things, and the horse just cut down on the back rail there. That is a very difficult turn. You could see even Dara with his expertise, he did it so well, but it's really a hard turn. And I think it's really a hard turn because of where the Rolex combination is sitting behind that jump. So you can't just angle it. You almost are forced to do 180 degrees.
And get straight to it and go in that direction. Finishing on the full faults there, 38-23. It's just four there for Dara Kenny and VDL Cartello. Carl Cook stays in the lead with Kalinka, 36-62. Daniel Blumen in second, Ladriano. Ben Mayer in third, 37-60. Still to come, though, is McLean Ward, Keane O'Connor, and Christian Kukuk. Little shot of the first, and as you say, was just trying to angle it. Gets a long way then.
Yeah, and his eyes were looking like, I love watching it, but it just... He didn't have a good enough momentum to get over, angle it, and turn in the air.
World number 10, McLean Ward, and new ride of Ilex for the Bonchance Farm. He was so excited about this horse in round one. They haven't been tested like this before. The question is, what will happen? The only thing we can do is wait and see, but McLean will give everything.
Here, great start. He started with more momentum. Great turn back. That looks slower for him. You know, the horse has a big stride and then a buck. Well, that'll be interesting. I don't know if that's going to... Great turn again. Let's see if he can get this one less, just like Carl. He's on it. Very quick.
Going to give it a go for McLean Ward and Ilex. A new combination might be a new win for them. It's going to run very close. Might. 36-64
he leads. Ah, I love it.
He said earlier on, the look on his face, he was so focused. He said, I'm coming out to win this, and he meant it.
Excellent.
McLean Ward, former winner here, of course, into this Grand Prix with the likes of Sapphire before now. Meredith, Michael Spearbaum alongside me, that was something special.
Yeah, I mean, I'm really amazed. It just shows what an expert McLean is and what an incredible rider. I mean, the horse is also fabulous, but that McLean pushed everything, you know, to the final limit, you know, on those very tricky rollbacks on a new horse. You know, the confidence he has in his own riding ability is just tremendous. I mean, just there are not many people who would go in there and, you know, risk everything like that with a new horse and show us all how it's done.
McLean Ward, former winner here, last one in 2019 with HH Azure Annie, that horse he rode to two legs of the majors of the Rolex Grand Slam as well, at Geneva and the Dutch Masters, and now has certainly said in a big way with Ilex, I am coming for you. But coming in now is Kian O'Connor, one of two left to go. The Irishman getting the final help and instructions down there from the floor. Huge experience. He finished on the podium earlier this season with Maurice into the five-star Grand Prix here in Wellington. There's a big ask here to catch McLean, but we saw where McLean lost time there as well.
Yeah, you know, there was a little buck in between with the horse, you know, and he's a bigger horse, so it was slower for him the distance, the number of strides to the combination, to the Rolex combination. I think the door is still open.
Yes.
I wouldn't say he shut the door, McLean, but he certainly has put the pressure on. So he's expecting the pressure to create faults. And as he told you, he's going to win. So
he's told us he's going to win. But there are a couple of that have got to have a little word about that, yes?
Yeah, it's not over yet. It's not over.
The Irish looking to continue their amazing streak here in Florida. Gets tight to the wall. Whoop, another buck.
Yeah, we got playful horses out there yes. tonight. That's good on week 12. McKeon looks a little slow. You could see that turn didn't work out for him.
So four on the scoreboard for Keane O'Connor. Just leaves Germany's Christian Kukuk to go up against McLean Ward and Elix.
Well, it's going to be interesting because I know my brother-in-law is one person who will be standing at the end gate telling Christian Kukuk exactly what he needs to do to take this win home to Germany. But boy, McLean really put the pressure on. So.
Yeah, McLean and Elix, as we said a little bit earlier on, putting the potential for Paris on their sights as well. Just got a little deeper in there.
Yeah, that's a hard turn.
There's the Irish chef to keep, Michael Blake, hopping around. One left to come in tonight's $500,000 Rolex Grand Prix. Is it going to be McLean Ward for the home crowd of the USA with the Elix, his first real test for this Olympic potential horse? And they've certainly shown the world what they can do here tonight. This has been a massive step up for that pairing together. But one stands in the way who has, again, the experience, the ability. There's McLean. He's going to go up there, ready, watch, and as you say.
You know, it's a funny position to be in because you as a rider, of course, you're hoping and praying you're going to be the winner. So you ask yourself, should I watch? Should I not watch?
Yeah.
Maybe I won't watch. Oh, I want to watch. It's just, you don't know what to do.
It's tough.
But I know one thing for sure. This young man is going to give everything he has to bring that win home to Germany tonight.
World number 20, Christian Kukuk of Germany, checker 47, riding for the wonderful owner, Madeleine Winterschutz, here as well. Last to go in the Rolex Grand Prix. It is McLean Ward that leads 36-2-4. But this pair have all the ability and has the legendary three-time gold medalist, Luca Bierbaum, on the floor, giving assistance as well. Can they do it, or is it going to the US? Good turn to the wall.
Gave himself a little more room to the wall there to keep the forward momentum. Ooh, look deep coming in. Oh, I don't know. Here he's going to have to take some risks. Whoa.
Oh, wow, he risked it.
The crowd is cheering.
Squeaking with excitement. 36-2-4 to beat. He's got a very good chance, a very, very good chance. Christian Kukuk coming home.
He did it.
It's going to be enough.
35-82. Wow.
Christian Kukuk, wow. Checker 47, just pushes out McLean Ward from the top spot. There's going to be a happy Bierbaum camp.
Oh, yes. I can't even imagine. But I must say that was so expertly ridden. Oh, look.
Yeah, McLean
and his
kids.
Daughters. Wow. Wow, 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 is all I can say. You know, he didn't push it to the wall. He gave himself an extra stride. Then he risked everything there to that rollback. Then he knew he was on it. He knew he was on it. Look at that, one less there. And what a ride. That was brilliant.
What a ride. What a finish. And Christian Kukuk makes his visit here to Wellington, a winning one here for the Rolex Grand Prix here tonight. Congratulations to him with checker 47. Superb competition overall. McLean Ward and Elix keeping it close, 36-2-4 from him. But in the end, Christian Kukuk at 35-82 claims the cast. Les Lugger, delighted.
Oh, that was so exciting. What a fun class to watch, and watching Christian at the end. I know McLean is going to be excited anyway with his wonderful performance.
He'll be happy with that as well.
Horse. Yeah, yeah.
And the good thing is he sees his two young daughters down there, gives a smile and said, okay, I gave him my best shot.
Exactly.
There we go. Christian Kukuk brings home $165,000 as the winner there. McLean Ward, $100,000 there goes in his direction. Top three for Carl Cook. So USA with two of the top three, but just Germany keeping him off the top place. Daniel Blumen, terrific start into that jump off with Ladriano Zed, an eventual fourth place for him. Ben Mayer, Dallas Vegas Batty finishing top five. Dara Kenny into sixth with Vidal Cartello to complete their day for the Irishman. And then to those other jump off combinations, Kendra Clarissia Brinkop in time, finishing in seventh. Eighth to Laura Crowder Bisquetta, and ninth to Keane O'Connor. The defending champion finishes in tenth in the end from round one, with Sapanu Balubay, Ashley Bond and Donatello into 11th, and top 12 for an excited but probably slightly frustrated Henrik von Eckermann and Khaleesi, who jumped a superb round there as well as part of tonight's Rolex Grand Prix. We're going to catch up with our winning rider as well. Superb performance from Christian Kukuk of Germany, and a very special night indeed. Celebrations get underway here in Palm Beach, but we'll get to that presentation first as well. So let's go down to Danny and have a chat with Christian.
Thanks, Stephen. I'm here with Christian. Congratulations. How exciting.
Woo.
Amazing. Talk us through the jump off.
Well, there was not so much to think. I thought, okay, I should not maybe turn as tight as the other ones to the wall, that I have the nine and the double a bit smoother. That actually went very well. And then I just thought, okay, if there is any chance for me, I have to have a really tight rollback to that Oxa. That went really, really well, and Checker tried unreal. And then I just thought, okay, just stay on the distance now you get. I did that, was flying home, and it's incredible.
Unbelievable.
Yeah, unbelievable, really.
Unbelievable. What does it mean to win here tonight?
That means actually really, really a lot for me. I mean, it's my very first time here in Wellington. Everyone told me how exciting the Saturday night class, especially the Rolex Grand Prix in the last week. And my first time here, I had a good feeling the whole week. I was second in the qualifier, so I thought, whoa, maybe it could be a good week for me. Checker, he's anyway since months in an unbelievable shape, and he did his job today. I'm so proud of him, and it really means a lot to win here the first time in Wellington and beating McLean in front of his home crowd.
Well, congratulations, fabulous. Thank you again.
Thank you.
All right, Stephen, back up to you.
Thank you, Danny. Yes, well, beating McLean in front of his home crowd. It is an exciting one, and well done to Christian. His first time here for the Rolex Grand Prix. He makes it a winning one as well, and as he said, an exciting night. Our thanks to Rolex once again, their long-time partnership, aligning with world-class athletes, as we see here tonight, creating excellence and stories of Rolex. Back after the break.
It is not a machine, though the precision of its mechanics can draw some admiration. Propelled by a unique movement, graced with a singular drive, it has a personality of its own. It was born from a special bond. Crafted over years with infinite patience and utmost care, listening to every tick, going over every move again and again to build a trust like no other. The kind of trust that allows you to push further, higher. Always. The kind of trust that can transcend any challenge.
Bainbridge is a fully integrated family of real estate companies who have developed and acquired more than 43,000 units representing $7.5 billion in transactions since inception. With over 650 associates nationally, Bainbridge engages in virtually every step of the real estate process, from development and construction, acquisition and disposition, to asset management and third-party property management of multifamily real estate. Bainbridge is the 10th largest multifamily developer and the 14th largest multifamily builder in the United States. Our team of experienced and knowledgeable professionals is devoted to creating exceptional living experiences for all of our residents and building lasting, mutually beneficial relationships with our partners and clients. To learn more, visit www.bainbridgecompanies.com.
Well, thank you to Rolex and the official timepiece here of Wellington International, title sponsor of tonight's headline class, and it's certainly been a headliner with some exciting news to come out of it, and it is a culmination of the Winter Equestrian Festival. Alongside me is Rolex testimony, Meredith Michaels-Birbaum. Meredith, let's take a look at the winning round once again here. Congratulations to Christian Kukuk. As we take another spin, Meredith, talk us through it.
Well, he started great over number one, and then, like he even admitted there, he gave himself a little more room to the wall, and it really actually rode so much better that way. He was a little wider to the combination, but that enabled him to keep going, keep the forward momentum, and here he took all the risk. And he gave a compliment to Checker how he gave everything to clear that jump. And then, this last line, he got the middle one very well and then gave everything here at the last. You can see it was far off. The horse just stayed in the air, kicked out his hind end and cleared the last jump.
Absolutely amazing stuff from Christian Kukuk and Checker 47, just pushing out McLean Ward and Illix in the end by just over half a second. And Carl Cook in third with Kalinka as we welcome those top three in for the presentation here tonight as well. Congratulations to them.
Look at Christian. I love it.
Christian Kukuk, ribbons in hand and in mouth, ready to hand out to the crowd as well. And very well done. And our leading three out there, it is, of course, McLean Ward and Kalinka with, of course, Carl Cook as well as they get set for their victory gallop. Wonderful cavalry charge of the three here tonight. And what a superb performance to lead them away, Christian Kukuk and Checker 47. And another success for Madeline, the owner as well here, who's just been one of the most wonderful owners in the sport, isn't it?
Oh, absolutely. Madeline Winter Schulze is an incredible person, a great sponsor for horses for many, many years, for the Bierbaum stable, for Ludger Bierbaum, but basically for all of the sport in Germany. She's been behind so many things, shows and awards. She is incredible.
Something special indeed for Christian Kukuk tonight. And well done to him. He's running out of hands.
You can see he has a great sense of humor.
Christian Kukuk, winner of the Rolex Grand Prix tonight. Very well done to him. Ribbons in all directions. And a solo spin for the winner of tonight's $500,000 class. Brilliant stuff from him once again, as you say. He's had an amazing year last year as well. He kicks off this year in fine style as well. And there we go. Getting ready to throw that out to the crowd, which was always the intention. And there we go. It's great to see the kids alongside the ring as well. And the fabulous grey Checker 47. Job done here for the Rolex Grand Prix here tonight. And superb stuff from the two Americans as well, McLean Ward and Carl Cook. As to screams and excitement, we're ready for the podium finish to tonight's Grand Prix class.
Yeah, I just have to say what an honor it is as a rider to be galloping around that ring with the Rolex blanket on your horse and the Rolex crown surrounding you. This is just such a great event, and we're also grateful to Rolex for being such a big player here for us in
Absolutely.
The equestrian sport.
Absolutely. A wonderful culmination to the season. Meredith Michaels-Birbaum, thank you very much for you, because you're a Rolex testimony as well, one of the greats, and it's wonderful to have a legend up here in the box. And we're honouring our legends with the Groom's Award as well that goes to the winning groom here, and that's presented by the Double H Farm. It will go to the winning groom.
And the horse is getting, of course, lots of carrots.
Yeah, lots of carrots. Mainstream munchies down there as well. It's been a wonderful night for them. As I say, it just remains for our top three to head on to the podium and receive their awards. An exciting season coming to a close here in Wellington. It's been 3 months of amazing competition.
Yeah, what a culmination here tonight. It was just fabulous, fun. Fun to commentate the whole thing with you, Stephen.
Pleasure. Absolute pleasure. thank you very much for taking the time. So let's come to our top three onto the podium. And well, we thought he might have got the job done, but finishing into third place in the end was Carl Cook, the Californian, with the exciting Kalinka. Again, I don't think he's going to be too disappointed. We can see the smiles and the joking around between the three of them down there as well. But up he goes, Carl Cook and Kalinka, the winners of the American Gold Cup. Carl Jungens there, sports marketing manager for Rolex USA, handing over, congratulations, and we'll be handing over the new Rolex watch as well to our winning rider too. A man who's taken a few of those home before now is McLean Ward and the Bonchance Farms Ilex, which is going to be a really exciting combination. Looking forward to see how they fare, and again, already with those eyes on Paris. I mean, that was an exciting one.
Yeah, I mean, I can only imagine how confident McLean feels after this class. As I mentioned, 2 weeks ago, he had two wins with two other horses. What a great string he's brought along.
Christian Kukuk, top of the podium. Congratulations tonight, and to receive a new Rolex watch as well from Kyle there. Delighted for a thrilling finish to the Rolex Grand Prix here tonight. It's one that's going to last in the memory for him, I think.
Yeah, I think this was an amazing win for him. He's had a lot of wins lately, but this has got to be one of the best to walk in here on new turf, you know, just show up here in Wellington and then take that Rolex home. It's not bad.
Absolutely. So delighted for him. McLean, I'm sure he's just saying, I've got several already. I'll get some more. I've got more coming. Don't worry about it.
It'll keep McLean hungry.
Yeah, it'll keep him hungry, but he's done it plenty of times. And so to the playing of the national anthem of our winning rider tonight for Germany. As they get the photos of our top three. A superb top three here tonight. Before we head to Champagne, as I say, traditional part of the ceremonies as well, with the national anthem of our winning rider too. Congratulations, and it'll be news heading home for Germany as well, as the anthem set to play out here across the Wellington grounds. Still a moment of frivolity between them before we get to that. And so for the top three, the final photos, they'll be whisking their way around the world. Two for the USA on the podium there, and the win for Germany. Congratulations to Christian Kukuk. An amazing season kicks off well here in Wellington. And some very special trophies being presented out there too. And the Marsha Dammerman Trophy presenting on behalf of the late Dennis Dammerman Perpetual Trophy, Michael Stone, President of Equestrian Sport Productions, to present that to the winning rider. Lots of big trophies and crystal and goodies that goes with winning this class. And as they turn the playing of the national anthem tonight of our winning rider, congratulations to Christian Kukuk. And trainer behind Luca Birbaum, representing Jeff. champagne time.
Oh, that looks like fun.
McLean is always quick off the draw. If you've watched him at all this season, he's been beat by Germany twice this season, Richard Vogel and Christian Kukuk. And there, congratulations from Carl Cook as well, as three delighted top-class riders complete this Rolex Grand Prix. There we go. McLean's got sneaky at that. They'll have revenge on him.
I think it's going to be a big night.
Absolutely.
They were so close in the end, and you know, just all had three tremendous performances here tonight.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, thank you to Meredith Michaels-Beerbaum for joining me here tonight. An exciting night of sports, and so much to owed also to our team here, and our thanks to Rolex for supporting once again. Amazing team behind the scenes that have bought the events here throughout the winter season. To all of you out there, wherever in the world, we hope you've enjoyed it. The world-class riders here, and we look forward to heading into next season. But it is a successful win. It was a superb lineup of riders. Daniel Blumen kicked things off into that jump off with an amazing try from him with L'Adriano Z. And then it all just kept on coming. Some superb highlights out of an amazing competition. Kendra Clarencia Brinkhoff finishing seventh place in the end for the German rider, but it was still the German flag at the top of the leaderboard in the end. Ben Mayer, the world number two, a top five finish for Ben to close things out. And then it was also into the lineup, a superb run for the American riders too, with Carl Cook, McLean Ward and Laura Crouch laying things on the table there for them too. And it was a good try with Bischetta for her, but an eventual further down the leaderboard spot, finishing in eighth place. Carl Cook set things alight with Kalinka van Zugvliet to eventually finishing into third spot. He was leading at this point. Could they do anything about it? Well, they would certainly try. And that the flamboyant American was certainly going to give everything to try and take home tonight's Rolex Grand Prix. In the mix was Dara Kenny and his Olympic ride, but it was not enough tonight. Again, four faults from them, with VDL Cartello, who would see an eventual sixth place in the end. And it is then to Illix and McLean Ward to finish in second, and a final win for Christian Kukuk to bring it home for the German rider. Thank you very much for joining us for an amazing night of sport. Ireland had a shot at it with Kian O'Connor, but not quite to be for them. But it has been an amazing season, the eventual winner being Christian Kukuk to close things out. Thank you to everyone who's been a part of this Wellington International production alongside ESPN. We look forward to seeing you in 2025. Good night.